Hey guys, how's everyone doing tonight?
Hope it's going well. No, don't want that.
Okay. That's ridiculously loud. Sorry that I'm starting so late. I let myself get distracted playing GTA 5, and yeah, I lost track of time a little bit, but I am here now. So there's that, at least. And we're going, and we're going to be starting a new book tonight. We'll be starting Artemis Fowl. I like these books a lot. And I own the entire series. I haven't read the entire series. I kind of got, I guess derailed from reading it, during the second to last book, the Atlantis Complex. I never ended up finishing reading that one. And then I didn't read the, final one. But I do own it, so, if you guys want, we can possibly end up reading the entire series, but that's kind of, gonna depend on viewer choice, probably, so. There we go. Okay. So, but yeah, for those that aren't familiar with Artemis Fowl, I'll read the back of the book. And I have the second and third books. I have two copies of them. So maybe I can do a giveaway or something at some point. Who knows? Maybe. Maybe not. I can always donate it to, like, a library or something. But yes. So, stay back, human. You don't know what you're dealing with. 12-year-old Artemis Fowl is a millionaire, a genius, and above all, a criminal mastermind. But even Artemis doesn't know what he's taken on when he kidnaps a fairy, Captain Holly Short of the LEP Recon Unit, or Leprechaun Unit. These aren't the fairies of bedtime stories. They're dangerous. Full of unexpected twists and turns, Artemis Fowl is a riveting, magical adventure. I did. Yes, I did go and get my hair trimmed up today. So it's shorter. Sides and the back as well. So I went and got that done today. So pretty happy with that. So once again, paid more money than probably necessary for the work done. But thank you, thank you. I like it a lot, so. And it's a lot better when the sides and back are shorter. It's just more comfortable, and I think it looks better. My mom would disagree, but why it's my hair, not hers. So I'm trying to see if there's a way to reduce. Oh, nope, not like that. If there's a way to reduce how much light there is on my face without making it harder for me to read. That's pretty good. So. And I can still read. Alright, we're golden. Okay. So I'm gonna go ahead and start the book. Gonna have the Alexander fight music playing in the background for the time I'm on this PC. Not exactly relaxing, but it's so fucking epic. Well, I mean, sometimes you just gotta have some epic in your life. I got this little bookmark for Christmas in Christmas Cracker, which, if you're not familiar with Christmas crackers, they are a typically British tradition. It's basically just like a little tube that you pull apart. It's got a little paper crown in it, a gift, and then usually either a joke or a trivia, something like that. So, and I happen to get a cute little bookmark, so quite happy with it. Comes in handy for Fiber Friday. Or not Fiber Friday, Comfy Corner. I could actually probably even like take a Sharpie or something on it and write Comfy Corner on the bookmark, which might be an idea. So, I don't know. I'm just saying random things, I guess. Alright, so let's go ahead and get started with the book. Prologue. How does one describe Artemis Fowl? Various psychiatrists have tried and failed. The main problem is Artemis's own intelligence. He bamboozles every test thrown at him. He has puzzled the greatest medical minds and sent many of them gibbering to their own hospitals. There is no doubt that Artemis is a child prodigy. But why does someone of such brilliance dedicate himself to criminal activities? This is a question that can be answered by only one person. And he delights in not talking. Perhaps the best way to create an accurate picture of Artemis is to tell the, by now, famous account of his first villainous venture. I have put together this report from first-hand interviews with the victims, and as the tale unfolds, you will realize that this was not easy. The story began several years ago, at the dawn of the 21st century. Artemis Fowl had devised a plan to restore his family's fortune, a plan that could topple civilizations and plunge the planet into a cross-species war. He was 12 years old at the time. Chapter 1. The Book. Ho Chi Minh, Min City in the summer. Sweltering by anyone's standards. Needless to say, Artemis Fowl would not have been willing to put up with such discomfort if something extremely important had not been at stake, important to the plan. Sun did not suit Artemis. He did not look well in it. Long hours indoors in front of a computer screen had bleached the glow from his skin. He was white as a vampire, and almost as testy in the light of day. Hold on, I'm trying to, because I know from my past with these books, I know that Artemis is Irish, so I'm going to attempt I hope this isn't another wild goose chase, Butler. Nope, not. I'm not happy with that. Ho Chi Minh, is that what it is? Ho Chi Minh City. Oh, lordy. I need to make him sound younger. I hope this isn't another wild goose chase, Butler, he said, his voice soft and clipped, especially after Cairo. It was a gentle rebuke. They had traveled to Egypt on the word of Butler's informant.
No, sir. I'm certain this time.
Nguyen?
Why, foreign names?
Nguyen is a good man. Droned Artemis, unconvinced. Passerbys would have been amazed to hear the large
Eurasian man refer to the boy as Sir. This was, after all, the third millennium. But this was no ordinary relationship, and these were no ordinary tourists. They were sitting outside a curbside cafe on Dong Kai Street, watching the local teenagers circle the square on mopeds. Nguyen was late, and the pathetic patch of shade provided by the umbrella was doing little to improve Artemis's mood. But this was his daily pessimism. I forgot about Artemis's nationality. It's been a while since I read this. Yeah. Kyle123Kyle1, thank you for the follow. Glad you're enjoying the stream thus far. Hope you continue to enjoy. And welcome to the dork side. How you doing tonight, Kyle? But yeah, one of my favorite things was always that, it wasn't until I found out that he was in Ireland that I put an Irish accent, like, in my mind, because I always imagine characters, when they're speaking in books, I always imagine them having, you know, I always imagine their voices, and so when I read the books, I try to kind of, as best my vocal cords can, reflect those headcanons, I guess. And it took a while before I actually had Artemis having a Irish accent, but once I found out that he was from Ireland, which is in a few chapters probably, partway through the book at least, ever since then, every single book that I've read, Irish accent constantly. It's a wonderful thing to hear in your mind's ear. If you, like me, enjoy accents. Anyway. But this was just his daily pessimism. Beneath the sulk was a spark of hope. Could this trip actually yield results? Would they find the book? It was too much to hope for. A waiter scurried to their table. "Maltesers?" he asked, head bobbing furiously. Artemis sighed. "Spare me the theatrics and sit down." The waiter turned instinctively to Butler, who was, after all, the adult.
"But, sir, I am..."
I've never been good at Chinese accents.
"I am the waiter."
Hold on, let me think. No, that would give me too much of a Japanese accent. I can't do that. Artemis tapped the table for attention.
You are wearing handmade loafers, a silk shirt, and 3 gold signet rings. Your English has a tinge of Oxford about it, and your nails have the soft sheen of the recently manicured. You are not a waiter. You are a contact, Nguyen Guan, and you have adopted this pathetic disguise to discreetly check for weaponry.
Nguyen's shoulders sagged.
It is true. Amazing. Hardly. A ragged apron does not a waiter make.
Nguyen sat, pouring some mint tea into a tiny china cup.
Let me fill you in on the weapon status, continued Artemis. I am unarmed, but Butler here, Butler, has a Sig Sauer in his shoulder holster, 2 strike-throwing knives in his boots, a Derringer 2 shots up his sleeve, garrote wire in his watch, and 3 stun grenades concealed in various pockets. Anything else, Butler?
The kosh, sir.
Oh, yes. A good old bar-bearing kosh stuffed down his shirt.
Nguyen brought the cup trembling to his lips.
Don't be alarmed, Mr. Xuan. God damn. Accents equal sexy as hell, I agree. Foreign names equal hard to pronounce
when reading. Artemis smiled. The weapons will not be used on you. Nguyen did not seem reassured.
No, continued Artemis. Butler could kill you 100 different ways without the use of his weapons, though I'm sure one would be quite sufficient.
Nguyen was by now thoroughly spooked. Artemis generally had that effect on people. A pale adolescent speaking with the authority and vocabulary of a powerful adult. Nguyen had heard the name Fowl before, who hadn't in the international underworld, but he'd assumed he'd be dealing with Artemis Sr., not this boy. Though the word boy hardly seemed to do this gaunt individual justice. And the giant, Butler. It was obvious he could snap a man's backbone like a twig with those mammoth hands. Nguyen was starting to think that no amount of money was worth another minute in this strange company. "And now to business," said Artemis, placing a micro recorder on the table. "You answered our web advertisements." I'm trying to remember how advertisement is pronounced across advertisement. Okay. "You answered our web advertisement." Nguyen nodded, silently praying that his information was accurate.
Yes, Mr. Fowl. What you're looking for, I know where it is."
"Really? And am I supposed to take your word for this? You could be walking me straight into an ambush. My family is not without enemies." Butler snatched a mosquito out of the air beside his employer's ear.
No, said Nguyen, reaching for his pocket, or for his wallet. "Here, look."
Artemis studied the Polaroid. He willed his heart to maintain a calm beat. It seemed promising, but anything could be faked these days with a PC and a flatbed scanner. The picture showed a hand reaching from layered shadows. A mottled green hand.
He murmured. "Explain."
"This woman, she is a healer, near Tudor Street. She works in exchange for rice wine. All the time, drunk."
Artemis nodded. It made sense, the drinking. One of the few consistent facts his research had unearthed.
He stood, pulling the creases from his white polo shirt.
"Very well. Lead on, Mr. Kwan."
Nguyen? I'm pronouncing his name different every single time. Nguyen wiped the sweat from his stringy mustache.
"Information only. That was the agreement. Don't want any costs on my head."
Butler expertly gripped the informant behind the neck.
"I'm sorry, Mr. Kwan, but the time when you had a choice in matters is long past."
Butler steered the protesting Vietnamese man. Oh, it's Vietnamese, not Chinese. I don't even know anything about Vietnamese pronunciations. Butler steered the protesting Vietnamese man to the rented four-wheel drive. It was hardly necessary on the flat streets of the Ho Chi Minh City, or Saigon, as the locals still called it, but Artemis preferred to be as insulated from civilians as possible. The jeep inched forward at a painfully slow rate, made all the more excruciating by the anticipation building in Artemis's chest. He could suppress it no longer. Could they at last be at the end of their quest? After 6 false alarms across 3 continents, could this wine-sodden healer be the gold at the end of the rainbow? Artemis almost chuckled. Gold at the end of the rainbow. He'd made a joke. Now there's something that didn't happen every day. The mopeds parted like fish in a giant shoal. There seemed to be no end to the crowds. Even the alleyways were full to bursting with vendors and hagglers. Saigon. Okay, Saigon. Got it. So, Ho Chi Minh, or Saigon. Okay. Thank you, Mr. Bello. Okay, the mopeds parted like fish in a giant shoal. There seemed to be no end to the crowds. Even the alleyways were full to bursting with vendors and hagglers. Cooks dropped fish heads into woks of sizzling oil, and urchins threaded their way underfoot, searching for unguarded valuables. Others sat in the shade, wearing out their thumbs on Game Boys. Nguyen
Nguyen was sweating right through his khaki top. It wasn't the humidity. He was used to that. It was this whole cursed situation. He should have known better than to mix magic and crime. He made a silent promise that if he got out of this, he would change his ways. No more answering shady internet requests, and certainly no more consorting with the sons of European crime lords. The name is spelled N-G-U-Y-E-N. Just waiting to see if I get a pronunciation. Okay. Awesome. I haven't been anywhere close. When. When. Okay. The Jeep could only go so far. Eventually, the side streets grew too narrow for the four-wheel drive. Artemis turned to When.
It seems you must proceed on foot, Master Juan. Run if you like, but expect a sharp and fatal pain between your shoulder blades.
Huynh glanced into Butler's eyes. They were a deep blue, almost black. There was no mercy in those eyes.
Don't worry, he said. I won't run.
Honestly, any attempt is better than mine. Better than me pronouncing it differently every single time.
They climbed down from the vehicle. A thousand suspicious eyes followed their progress along the steaming alley. An unfortunate pickpocket attempted to steal Butler's wallet. The manservant broke the man's fingers without looking down. They were given a wide berth after that. The alley narrowed to a rutted lane. Sewage and drain pipes fed directly onto the muddy surface. Cripples and beggars huddled on rice mat islands. Most of the residents of this lane had nothing to spare, with the exception of three.
Well? Demanded Artemis. Where is she?
Huynh jabbed a finger toward the black triangle beneath a rusted fire escape.
There, under there. She never comes out. Even to buy rice spirits, she sends a runner. Now, can I go?
Artemis didn't bother answering. Instead, he picked his way across the puddled lane to the lee of the fire escape. He could discern furtive movements in the shadows.
Butler, could you hand me the goggles?
Butler plucked a set of night vision glasses from his belt and placed them in Artemis's outstretched hand. The focus motor buzzed to suit the light. Artemis fixed the glasses to his face. Everything became radioactive green. Taking a deep breath, he turned his gaze to the squirming shadows. Something squatted on a raffia mat, shifting uneasily in the almost non-existent light. Artemis fine-tuned the focus. The figure was small, abnormally so, and wrapped in a filthy shawl. Empty spirit jugs were half buried in the mud around her. One forearm poked from the material. It seemed green, but then so did everything else.
Madam, he said, I have a proposition for you.
The figure's head wobbled sleepily.
Wine,
she rasped, her voice like nails on a school chalkboard.
Wine, English.
Artemis smiled. The gift of tongues? Check. Aversion to light? Check.
Irish, actually. Now, about my proposition.
The healer shook a bony finger craftily.
Wine first, then talk.
Butler? Okay, so 10 pages in is when you find out that he's Irish. The bodyguard reached into a pocket and drew out a half pint of the finest Irish whiskey. Artemis took the bottle and held it teasingly beyond the shadows. He barely had time to remove his goggles when the claw-like hand darted from the gloom to snatch the whiskey. A mottled green hand, there was no doubt. Artemis swallowed a triumphant grin. "Pay our friend Butler, in full. Remember, Mr. Juan, this is between us. You don't want Butler to come back, do you?"
"No, no, Mr. Fowl. My lips are sealed."
"They had better be, or Butler will see them permanently." Quinn skipped off down the alley, so relieved to be alive that he didn't even bother counting the sheaf of U.S. currency. Most unlike him. In any event, it was all there. All $20,000. Not bad for half an hour's work. Artemis turned back to the healer.
"Now, madam, you have something I want."
The healer's tongue caught a drop of alcohol at the corner of her mouth.
"Yes, Irish. Sore head, bad tooth. I heal."
Artemis replaced the night vision goggles and squatted to her level.
"I am perfectly healthy, madam. Apart from a slight dust mite allergy. And I don't think even you can do anything about that. No, what I want from you is your book."
The hag froze. Bright eyes glinted from beneath the shawl.
"Book?"
she said cautiously.
"I don't know about no book. I am a healer. You want book? Go to library."
Artemis sighed with exaggerated patience.
"You are no healer. You are a sprite, pishog, fairy, caldolan, whichever language you prefer to use, and I want your book."
For a long moment, the creature said nothing. Then she threw back the shawl from her forehead. In the green glow of the night vision goggles, her features leaped at Artemis like a Halloween mask. The fairy's nose was long and hooked under two slitted golden eyes. Her ears were pointed, and the alcohol addiction had melted her skin like putty.
"If you know about the book, human,"
she said slowly, fighting the numbing effects of the whiskey,
"then you know about the magic I have in my fist. I can kill you with a snap of my fingers."
Artemis shrugged.
"I think not. Look at you. You are near dead. The rice wine has dulled your senses. Reduced to healing warts. Pathetic. I'm here to save you, in return for the book."
"What could a human want with our book?"
"That is no concern of yours. All you need to know are your options."
The sprite's pointed ears quivered.
"Options?"
"One. You refuse to give us the book, and we go home, leaving you to rot in this sewer."
"Yes,"
said the fairy.
"I choose this option."
"Ah, no. Don't be so eager. If we leave without the book, you will be dead in a day."
"A day? A day?"
the healer laughed.
"I will outlive you by a century. Even fairies tethered to the human realm can survive the ages."
"Not with half a pint of holy water inside them,"
said Artemis, tapping the now empty whiskey bottle. The fairy blanched, then screamed, a high, keening, horrible sound.
"Holy water! You have murdered me, human!"
"True," admitted Artemis. "It should start to burn any minute now."
The fairy poked her stomach tentatively.
"The second option?"
"Listening now, aren't we? Very well then. Option two. You give me the book for 30 minutes only. Then I return your magic to you."
The sprite's jaw dropped.
"Return my magic? Not possible."
"Oh, but it is. I have in my possession two ampoules. One,
A boil of spring water from the fairy well 60 meters below the Ring of Tara, possibly the most magical place on Earth. This will counteract the holy water.
And the other?
The other is a little shot of man-made magic, a virus that feeds on alcohol, mixed with a growth agent. It'll flush every drop of rice wine from your body, remove the dependence, and even bolster your failing liver. It'll be messy, but after a day you'll be zipping around as though you were 1,000 years old again. The sprite licked her lips. To be able to rejoin the people? Tempting.
How do I know to trust you, human? You have tricked me once already.
Good point. Here's the deal. I'll give you the water on faith. Then, after I've had a look at the book, you get the booster. Take it or leave it. The fairy considered. The pain was already curling around her abdomen. She thrust out her wrist.
I'll take it.
I thought you might. Butler? The giant manservant unwrapped a soft, velcroed case containing a syringe gun and 2 vials. He loaded the clear one, shooting it into the sprite's clammy arm. The fairy stiffened momentarily and then relaxed.
Strong magic,
she breathed. Yes, but not as strong as your own will be when I give you the second injection. Now, the book. The sprite reached into the folds of her filthy robe, rummaging for an age. Artemis held his breath. This was it. Soon, the fowls would be great again. A new empire would rise, and Artemis Fowl II at its head. The fairy woman withdrew a closed fist.
No use to you anyway. Written in the old tongue.
Artemis nodded, not trusting himself to speak. She opened her knobbly fingers. Lying in her palm was a tiny, golden volume the size of a matchbox.
Here, human. 30 of your minutes. No more.
Butler took the tiny tome reverently. The bodyguard activated a compact digital camera and began photographing each wafer-thin page of the book. The process took several minutes. When he was finished, the entire volume was stored on the camera's chip. Artemis preferred not to take chances with information. Airport security equipment had been known to wipe many a vital disk. So, he instructed his aide to transfer the file to his portable phone, and from there, email it to Fowl Manor in Dublin. Before the 30 minutes were up, the file containing every symbol in the fairy book was sitting safely in the Fowl server. Artemis returned the tiny volume to its owner. Nice doing business with you. The sprite lurched to her knees.
The other potion, human?
Artemis smiled. Oh yes, the restoring booster. I suppose I did promise.
Yes, human promised.
Very well. But before we administer it, I must warn you that purging is not pleasant. You are not going to enjoy this one bit. The fairy gestured around her at the squalid filth.
You think I enjoy this? I want to fly again.
Butler loaded the second vial, shooting this one straight into the carotid artery. The sprite immediately collapsed on the mat, her entire frame quivering violently.
Time to leave, commented Artemis. 100 years of alcohol leaving a body by any means possible is not a pretty sight.
The butlers had been serving the fowls for centuries. It had always been that way. Indeed, there were several eminent linguists of the opinion that this was... that this was how the common noun had originated. The first record of this unusual arrangement was when Virgil Butler had been contracted as a servant, bodyguard, and cook to Lord Hugo de Foule for one of the first great Norman Crusades. At the age of 10, Butler children were sent to a private training center in Israel, where they were taught the specialized skills necessary to guard the latest in the fowl line. These skills included cordon bleu cooking, marksmanship, a customized blend of martial arts, emergency medicine, and information technology.
If, at the end of their training, there was not a fowl to guard, then the butlers were eagerly snapped up as bodyguards for various royal personages, generally in Monaco or Saudi Arabia. Once a fowl and a butler were put together, they were paired for life. It was a demanding job and lonely, but the rewards were handsome if you survived to enjoy them. If not, then your family received a 6-figure settlement, plus a monthly pension. The current butler had been guarding young Master Artemis for 12 years, since the moment of his birth. And though they adhered to the age-old formalities, they were much more than master and servant. Artemis was the closest thing Butler had to a friend, and Butler was the closest Artemis had to a father, albeit one that obeyed orders. Butler held his tongue until they were aboard the Heathrow connection from Bangkok. Then he had to ask,
"Artemis?"
Artemis looked up from the screen of his powerbook. He was getting a head start on the translation.
"Yes?" "The sprite. Why didn't we simply keep the book and leave her to die?"
"A corpse is evidence, Butler. My way, the people will have no reason to be suspicious."
"But the sprite?"
"I hardly think she will confess to showing humans the book. In any case, I mixed a slight amnesiac into her second injection. When she finally wakes up, the last week will be a blur."
Butler nodded appreciatively. Always 2 steps ahead, that was Master Artemis. People said he was a chip off the old block. They were wrong. Master Artemis was a brand new block, the likes of which had never been seen before. Doubts assuaged, Butler returned to his copy of Guns and Ammo, leaving his employer to unravel the secrets of the universe. "Hey, DT, how are you tonight?" "Is that Guan Yu?" "Been here for like 20 seconds. I can hardly keep my eyes open." "Well, that's one of the points of the comfy corner, so how are you doing tonight, both DT and Guan Yu?" Chapter 2. Translation. If I could get super high, I would listen to this stream. So you wouldn't listen to the stream unless you were high? Tired. I need beds. Also a little sad. Just finished up season 13 of RVB.
Yeah. I know that feel, DT. It hurts on a spiritual level.
Also, beds is important. Get seeps. Going through some of my old tweets and responses, and I found some weird shit. Oh dear, Mr. B. So teary at the end. Indeed. I would, but just think of someone reading you. Oh, so if someone was high and reading you a book? Or are you talking about a book high where you sit there and listen to someone reading a book and it's just like, oh my god, this is wonderful, I'm so relaxed. Or even reading a book yourself and feeling that way. Books are very relaxing things for me. I don't need drugs. I have books. Here's one. So is it bad that I want to learn more Japanese to play porn games? Mr. B! I think I might fall asleep to this. Well, you're more than welcome to, Guan. That's one of the reasons I do the comfy corners. Helpful for sleep and relaxation and just books. Guan Yu 11, thank you for the follow. Glad you're enjoying the stream thus far. Hope you continue to enjoy. And welcome to the dork side. Just wanted to say hi and stuff before bed. Exam in 6 hours. Go to sleep, son. Go to sleep. I love you, but go to bed. Goodness gracious.
Also, good luck on your exam. I hope it goes well. Yes, we are very glad you stopped by. But get the sleeps. Okay. Chapter 2. Translation. By now, you... Oh, let me see. Thanks, it's math, so, you know. Nighty-night. Good night, DT. Hopefully, rest gives you a nice, sharp mind. And you do well on the exam. I have faith in you. Okay. By now, you must have guessed just how far Artemis Fowl was prepared to go in order to achieve his goal. But what exactly was this goal? What outlandish scheme would involve the blackmailing of an alcohol-addicted sprite? The answer was gold. Artemis's search had begun 2 years previously, when he first became interested in surfing the internet. He quickly found the more arcane sites, alien abduction, UFO sightings, and the supernatural, but most specifically, the existence of the people. Trawling through gigabytes of data, he found hundreds of references to fairies from nearly every country in the world. Each civilization had its own term for the people, but they were undoubtedly members of the same hidden family. Several stories mentioned a book carried by each fairy. It was their Bible, containing, as it allegedly did, the history of their race and the commandments that governed their extended lives. Of course, this book was written in Gnomish, the fairy language, and would be no use to any human. Artemis believed that with today's technology, the book could be translated. And with this translation, you could begin to exploit a whole new group of creatures. Know thine enemy was Artemis's motto, so he immersed himself in the lore of the people until he had compiled a huge database on their characteristics. But it wasn't enough. So Artemis put out a call on the web. Irish businessmen will pay large amount of US dollars to meet a fairy, sprite, leprechaun, pixie. The responses had been mostly fraudulent, but Ho Chi Minh City had finally paid off. Artemis was perhaps the only person alive who could take full advantage of his recent acquisition. He still retained a childlike belief in magic, tempered by an adult determination to exploit it. If there was anybody capable of relieving the fairies of some of their magical gold, it was Artemis Fowl II. It was early morning before they reached Fowl Manor. Artemis was anxious to bring up the file on his computer, but first he decided to call in on Mother. Angeline Fowl was bedridden. She had been since her husband's disappearance. Nervous tension, the physician said. Nothing for it but rest and sleeping pills. That was almost a year ago. Butler's little sister Juliet was sitting at the foot of the stairs. Her gaze was boring a hole in the wall. Even the glitter mascara couldn't soften her expression. Artemis had seen that look already, just before Juliet had suplexed a particularly impudent pizza boy. The suplex, Artemis gathered, was a wrestling move. An unusual obsession for a teenage girl, but then again, she was, after all, a butler.
Problems, Juliet?
Juliet straightened hurriedly.
My own fault, Artemis. Apparently, I left a gap in the curtains. Mrs. Fowl couldn't sleep.
Muttered Artemis, scaling the oak staircase slowly. He worried about his mother's condition. She hadn't seen the light of day in a long time now. Then again, should she miraculously recover, emerging revitalized from her bedchamber, it would signal the end of Artemis's own extraordinary freedom. It would be back off to school and no more spearheading criminal enterprises for you, my boy. He knocked gently on the arched double doors.
Mother, are you awake? Something smashed against the other side of the door. It sounded expensive.
Of course I'm awake. How can I sleep in this blinding glare?
Artemis ventured inside. An antique four-poster bed threw shadowy spires in the darkness, and a pale sliver of light poked through a gap in the velvet curtains. Angeline Fowl sat hunched on the bed, her pale limbs glowing white in the gloom.
Artemis, darling, where have you been?
Artemis sighed. She recognized him. That was a good sign. School trip, mother. Skiing in Austria.
Ah, skiing?
Crooned Angeline.
How I miss it. Maybe when your father returns.
Artemis felt a lump in his throat. Most uncharacteristic.
Yes, perhaps when father returns.
Darling, could you close those wretched curtains? The light is intolerable.
Of course, mother.
Artemis felt his way across the room, wary of the low-level clothes chest scattered around the floor. Finally, his fingers curled around the velvet drapes. For a moment, he was tempted to throw them wide open. Then he sighed and closed the gasp.
Thank you, darling. By the way, we really have to get rid of that maid. She is good for absolutely nothing.
Artemis held his tongue. Juliet had been a hard-working and loyal member of the Fowl household for the past 3 years. Time to use Mother's absent-mindedness to his advantage.
You're right, of course, Mother. I've been meaning to do it for some time. Butler has a sister I believe would be perfect for the position. I think I've mentioned her. Juliet.
Angeline frowned.
Juliet? Yes, the name does seem familiar. Well, anyone would be better than that silly girl we have now. When can she start?
Straight away. I'll have Butler fetch her from the lodge.
You're a good boy, Artemis. Now give Mummy a hug.
Artemis stepped into the shadowy folds of his mother's robe. She smelled perfumed, like petals in water, but her arms were cold and weak.
Oh, darling,
she whispered, and the sound sent goosebumps popping down Artemis's neck.
I hear things at night. They crawl along the pillows and into my ears.
Artemis felt that lump in his throat again.
Perhaps we should open the curtains, Mother.
No!
His mother sobbed, releasing him from her grasp.
No, because then I could see them too.
Mother, please.
But it was no use. Angeline was gone. She crawled to the far corner of the bed, pulling the quilt under her chin.
Send the new girl.
Yes, Mother.
Send her with cucumber slices and water.
Yes, Mother.
Angeline glared at him with crafty eyes.
And stop calling me Mother. I don't know who you are, but you're certainly not my little Artie.
Artemis blinked back a few rebellious tears.
Of course. Sorry, Mother. Sorry.
Don't come back here again, or I'll have my husband take care of you. He's a very important man, you know.
Very well, Mrs. Fowl. This is the last you'll see of me.
It had better be.
Angeline froze suddenly.
Do you hear them?
Artemis shook his head.
No, I don't hear any.
They're coming for me. They're everywhere.
Angeline dived for cover beneath the bedclothes. Artemis could still hear her terrified sobs as he descended the marble staircase. The book was proving far more stubborn than Artemis had anticipated. It seemed to be almost actively resisting him. No matter which program he ran it through, the computer came up blank. Artemis hard-copied every page, tacking them to the walls of his study. There we go. Sometimes it helped to have things on paper. The script was like nothing he'd seen before, and yet it was strangely familiar. Obviously a mixture of symbolic and character-based language, the text meandered around the page in no apparent order. What the program needed was some frame of reference, some central point on which to build.
He separated all the characters and ran comparisons with English, Chinese, Greek, Arabic, and with Cyrillic texts, even Ogham. Nothing. Moody with frustration, Artemis sent Juliet scurrying when she interrupted with sandwiches, and moved on to symbols. The most frequently reoccurring pictogram was a small male figure. Male, he presumed, though with a limited knowledge of the fairy anatomy, he supposed it could be female. A thought struck him. Artemis opened the ancient languages file on his power translator and selected Egyptian. At last, a hit. The male symbol was remarkably similar to the Anubis god representation on Tutankhamun's inner chamber hieroglyphics. This was consistent with his other findings. The first written human stories were about fairies, suggesting that their civilization predated man's own. It would seem that the Egyptians had simply adapted an existing scripture to suit their needs. There were other resemblances, but the characters were just dissimilar enough to slip through the computer's net. This would have to be done manually. Each gnomish figure had to be enlarged, printed, and then compared with the hieroglyphics. Artemis felt the excitement of success thumping inside his ribcage. Almost every fairy pictogram or letter had an Egyptian counterpart. Most were universal, such as the sun or birds. But some seemed exclusively supernatural and had to be tailored to fit. The Anubis figure, for example, would make no sense to dog god, so Artemis altered it to read King of the Fairies. By midnight, Artemis had successfully fed his findings into the Macintosh. All he had to do now was press decode. He did so. What emerged was a long, intricate string of meaningless gibberish. A normal child would have abandoned the task long since. The average adult would probably have been reduced to slapping the keyboard. But not Artemis. This book was testing him, and he would not allow it to win. The letters were right, he was certain of it. It was just the order that was wrong. Rubbing the sleep from his eyes, Artemis glared at the pages again. Each segment was bordered by a solid line. This could represent paragraphs or chapters, but they were not meant to be read in the usual left-to-right, top-to-bottom fashion. Artemis experimented. He tried the Arabic right-to-left and the Chinese columns. Nothing worked. Then he noticed that each page had one thing in common: a central section. The other pictograms were arranged around this pivotal area. So, a central starting point, perhaps. But where to go from there? Artemis scanned the pages for some other common factor. After several minutes, he found it. There was, on each page, a tiny spearhead in the corner of one section. Could this be an arrow? A direction? Go this way? So the theory would be, start in the middle, then follow the arrow, reading in spirals. Batem? Was there something that I read weird? Or did I mispronounce bottom? I said bottom instead of bottom. Oh, I do that sometimes. That moment when you tried to inhale while drinking. Goodness gracious. Excuse me.
Don't choke to death, that would ruin your whole weekend. It really would. The computer program wasn't built to handle something like this. So Artemis had to improvise. With a craft knife and ruler, he dissected the first page of the book and reassembled it in the traditional Western languages order. Left to right, parallel rows. Then he rescanned the page and fed it through the modified Egyptian translator. The computer hummed and whirred, converting all the information to binary. Several times it stopped to ask for confirmation of a character or symbol. This happened less and less as the machine learned the new language. Eventually, two words flashed on the screen. File converted. Fingers shaking from exhaustion and excitement, Artemis clicked print. A single page scrolled from the laser writer. It was in English now. Yes, there were mistakes, some fine-tuning needed, but it was perfectly legible. And more importantly, perfectly understandable. Fully aware that he was probably the first human in several thousand years to decode the magical words, Artemis switched on his desk light and began to read. The Books of the People, being instructions to our magics and life rules. Carry me always, carry me well. I am thy teacher of herb and spell. I am thy link to power arcane. Forget me, and thy magic shall wane. 10 times 10 commandments there be. They will answer every mystery. Cures, curses, alchemy, the secret shall be thine through me. But, fairy, remember this above all. I am not for those in mud that crawl, and forever doomed shall be the one who betrays my secrets one by one. Artemis could hear the blood pumping in his ears. He had them. They would be as ants beneath his feet. Their every secret would be laid bare by technology. Suddenly, the exhaustion claimed him, and he sank back in his chair. There was so much yet to complete. Forty-three pages to be translated for a start. He pressed the intercom button that linked him to the speakers all over the house. Butler, get Juliet and come up here. There's some jigsaws I need you to assemble. Perhaps a little family history would be useful at this point. The Fowls were, indeed, legendary criminals. For generations, they had skirmished on the wrong side of the law, hoarding enough funds to become legitimate. Of course, once they were legitimate, they found it not to their liking, and returned almost immediately to crime. It was Artemis I, our subject's father, who had thrown the family fortune into jeopardy. With the breakup of communist Russia, Artemis Sr. had decided to invest a huge chunk of the Fowl fortune in establishing new shipping lines to the vast continent. New consumers, he reasoned, would need new consumer goods. The Russian mafia did not take too kindly to a Westerner muscling in on their market.
and so decided to send a little message. The message took the form of a stolen missile launched at the Fowl Star. On her way past Murmansk, Artemis Sr. was on board the ship, along with Butler's uncle and 250,000 cans of cola. It was quite an explosion. The Fowls were not left destitute. Far from it. But billionaire status was no longer theirs. Artemis II vowed to remedy this. He would restore the family fortune, and he would do it in his own unique fashion. Hello, Kiwi. Hello, Vigenda. How are you tonight? Hope you're both doing well. Apparently, Mr. Bolo. Apparently. By the way, Mr. Bolo, paragraph come up again, it's a permanent ban. Or anything that makes you think that it is the same person. Just go ahead and permaban. Hi, I'm friendly. No worries, Kiwi. Doing well now that I got you to read me a story. Aw, yay. I'm glad that it is helping you do well, Vigenda. I permabanned the last two guys with that paragraph. Yeah. 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 We're just gonna leave it at that. Okay. I do find it moderately amusing that there's the ideal that changing symbols makes something not a slur. But I guess I can go in to my bot and add those particular interesting spellings. Of course you showed me what you got. I like what you got. Rick and Morty reference. I'm not familiar with Rick and Morty. Excuse me. Yeah, it happens every now and then, Kiwi. Okay. Once the book was translated, Artemis could begin planning in earnest. He already knew what the ultimate goal was. Now, he could figure out how to achieve it. Yes, Paladin Mike, this is the first Artemis Fowl book. And we're on the, second chapter? Yes, we're on chapter 2 currently, so. Okay. Gold, of course, was the objective. Yeah, it happens, Mr. B. How am I supposed to work under these conditions? Well, not sure. Not sure, man. Okay. The acquisition of gold. It seemed that the people were almost as fond of the precious metal as humans. Each fairy had its own cache, but not for much longer if Artemis had his way. There would be at least one of the fairy folk wandering around with empty pockets by the time he'd finished. After 18 solid hours of sleep and a light continental breakfast, Artemis climbed to the study that he had inherited from his father. It was a traditional enough room, dark oak and floor-to-ceiling shelving, but Artemis had jammed it with the latest computer technology. A series of networked Apple Macs whirred from various corners of the room. One was running CNN's website, through a DAT projector, DAT projector, throwing oversized current affair images against the back wall. Butler was there already, firing up the hard drives.
Shut them all down, except the book. I need quiet for this.
The manservant started. The CNN site had been running for almost a year. Artemis was convinced that news of his father's rescue would come from there. Shutting it down meant that he was finally letting go.
All of them?
Artemis glanced at the back wall for a moment. Yes, he said finally. All of them. Butler took the liberty of patting his employer gently on the shoulder, just once, before returning to work. Artemis cracked his knuckles. Time to do what he did best. Plot dastardly acts. Chapter 3. Holly. Holly Short was lying in bed, silently fuming. Nothing unusual about this. Leprechauns in general were not known for their geniality. But Holly wasn't in an exceptionally bad mood, even for a fairy.
Excuse me.
Technically, she was an elf, fairy being a general term. She was a leprechaun too, but that was just a job. Perhaps a description would be more helpful than a lecture on fairy genealogy. Holly Short had nut-brown skin, cropped auburn hair, and hazel eyes. Her nose had a hook, and her mouth was plump and cherubic, which was appropriate considering Cupid was her great-grandfather. Her mother was a European elf with a fiery temper and willowy figure. Holly, too, had a slim frame with long tapered fingers, perfect for wrapping around a buzz baton. Her ears, of course, were pointed. Anarchy, thank you for the follow. Glad you're enjoying the stream thus far. Hope you continue to enjoy, and welcome to the dork side. At exactly 3 feet in height, Holly was only a centimeter below the fairy average. But even 1 centimeter can make an awful lot of difference when you don't have many to spare. Commander Root was the cause of Holly's distress. Root had been on Holly's case since day one. The commander had decided to take offense at the fact that the first female officer in Recon's history had been assigned to his squad. Recon was a notoriously dangerous posting with a high fatality rate. And Root didn't think it was any place for a girlie. Well, he was just going to have to get used to the idea, because Holly Short had no intention of quitting for him or anybody else. Can't ban Archie the Anarchy, thank you for the follow. Glad you're enjoying the stream, hope you continue to enjoy, and welcome to the dork side. Not gonna unban you, though. Paladin Mike, thank you for the follow. Glad you're enjoying the stream thus far. Hope you continue to enjoy. And as always, welcome to the dork side. Okay, there we are. Though she'd never admit it, another possible cause for Holly's irritability was the ritual. She'd been meaning to perform it for several moons now. But somehow, there just never seemed to be time. And if Root found out that she was running low on magic, she'd be transferred to traffic for sure. That's a very good comeback, Vachinda. That is wonderful. Holly rolled off her futon and stumbled into the shower. That was one advantage of living near the Earth's core. The water was always hot. Oh my god, guys, I need to move to the Earth's core. Hot water. Yes, please. No natural light, of course, but that was a small price to pay for privacy. Underground, the last human-free zone. There was nothing like coming home after a long day on the job, switching off your shield, and sinking into a bubbling slime pool. Bliss. The fairy suited up, zipping the dull green jumpsuit up to her chin and strapping on her helmet. Leprechaun uniforms were stylish these days. Not like the top-of-the-morning costume the force had to wear back in the old days. Permaban Archie the Anarchy, thank you for the follow. Glad you're enjoying the stream. Hope you continue to enjoy. Welcome to the dork side. I say it every time, guys. I say it every time. I know. I know, Mr. B. It's summer here. I need to make a new poll. I need to make a new poll, Mr. B. I just haven't yet because I'm lazy. I need to make a new poll for both of them because the book poll has been... is this was on the book poll and this was the winner, so... Yeah, I need to, boom, chicka brown cow. Brown chicken, brown cow. But yes. I need to fix both poles. Okay. Not like that top-of-the-morning costume the force had to wear back in the old days. Buckled shoes and knickerbockers. Honestly. No wonder leprechauns were such a ridiculous figure in human folklore. Still, probably better that way. If the mud people knew that the word leprechaun actually originated from L.E.P. Recon, an elite branch of the Lower Elements Police, they'd probably take steps to stamp them out. Better to stay inconspicuous and let the humans have their stereotypes. With the moon already rising on the surface, there was no time for a proper breakfast. Holly grabbed the remains of a nettle smoothie from the cooler and drank it in the tunnels. As usual, there was chaos in the main thoroughfare. Airborne sprites jammed the avenue like stones in a bottle. The gnomes weren't helping either, lumbering along with their big swinging behinds blocking two lanes. Swear toads infested every damp patch, cursing like sailors. That particular breed began as a joke, but had multiplied into an epidemic. Someone lost their wand over that one. Holly battled through the crowds to the police station. There was already a riot outside Spud's Spud Emporium. Lep Corporal Newt. I'm just gonna have it be Lep rather than L-E-P. Lep Corporal Newt was trying to sort it out. Good luck to him. Nightmare. At least Holly got the chance to work above ground. The Lep station doors were crammed with protesters. The goblin dwarf turf war had flared up again. And every morning, hordes of angry parents showed up demanding the release of their innocent offspring. Holly snorted. If there actually was an innocent goblin, Holly Short had yet to meet him. They were clogging up the cells now, howling gang chants and hurling fireballs at each other. Holly shouldered her way into the throng. "Coming through," she grunted. "Police business." They were on her like flies on a stinkworm. "My grandpa is innocent. Police brutality. Officer, could you take my baby his blankie? He can't sleep without it." Holly set her visor to reflect and ignored them all. Once upon a time, the uniform would have earned you some respect. Not anymore. Now you were a target.
"Excuse me, officer, but I seem to have misplaced my jar of warts. Pardon me, young elf, but my cat's climbed a stalactite. Or, if you have a minute, captain,
Could you tell me how to get to the Fountain of Youth?
Holly shuddered. Tourists. She had troubles of her own. More than she knew, as she was about to find out. In the station lobby, a kleptomaniac dwarf was busy picking the pockets of everyone else in the booking line, including the officer he was handcuffed to. Holly gave him a swipe in the backside with her buzz baton. The electric charge cinched the seat of his leather pants.
What you doing there, Mulch?
Mulch started, contraband dropping from his sleeves.
Officer Short,
he whined, his face a mask of regret.
I can't help myself. It's my nature.
I know that, Mulch. And it's our nature to throw you in a cell for a couple of centuries.
She winked at the dwarf's arresting officer.
Nice to see you staying alert.
The elf blushed, kneeling to pick up his wallet and badge. Holly forged past Root's office, hoping she would make it to her cubicle before...
Short! Get in here!
Holly sighed. Oh well. Here we go again. Stowing her helmet under her arm, Holly smoothed the creases from her uniform and stepped into Commander Root's office. Root's face was purple with rage. This was more or less his general state of existence, a fact that had earned him the nickname Beetroot. There was an office pool running on how long he had before his heart exploded. The smart money was on half a century, at the outside.
Oh, well, I'm glad it's helping you feel better, Mr. Bellow, and I'm glad you find it relaxing, Kiwi.
Also, yes, I love the, leprechaun. Leprechaun thing. Yeah, that's fantastic. Commander Root was tapping the moonometer on his wrist.
Well?
He demanded.
What time do you call this?
Holly could feel her own face coloring. She was barely a minute late. There were at least a dozen officers on their shift who hadn't even reported in yet. But Root always singled her out for persecution.
The thoroughfare, she mumbled lamely. There were four lanes down.
Don't insult me with your excuses,
roared the commander.
You know what the city center is like. Get up a few minutes earlier.
Oh no.
It was true. She did know what Haven was like. Holly Short was a city elf born and bred. Since the humans had begun experimenting with mineral drilling, more and more fairies had been driven out of the shallow forts and into the depth and security of Haven City. The metropolis was overcrowded and underserviced, and now there was a lobby to allow automobiles in the pedestrianized city center. As if the place wasn't smelly enough already with all these country gnomes lumbering around the place. Root was right. She should get up a bit earlier. But she wouldn't. Not until everybody else was forced to.
I know what you're thinking, said Root. Why am I picking on you every day? Why don't I ever bawl out those other layabouts?
Holly said nothing, but agreement was written all over her face.
I'll tell you why, shall I?
Holly risked a nod.
It's because you're a girl.
Holly felt her fingers curl into fists. She knew it.
But not for the reasons you think,
continued Root.
You're the first girl in Recon. Ever. You are a test case. A beacon. There are a million fairies out there watching your every move. There are a lot of hopes riding on you. But there's a lot of prejudice against you, too. The future of law enforcement is in your hands. And at the moment, I'd say it was a little heavy.
Holly blinked. Root had never said anything like this before. Usually it was just,
fix your helmet. Stand up straight.
Blah, blah, blah.
You have to be the best you can be, Short, and that has to be better than everyone else.
Root sighed, sinking into his swivel chair.
I don't know, Holly. Ever since that Hamburg incident...
Holly winced. The Hamburg incident had been a total disaster. One of her perps had skipped out to the surface and tried to bargain with the mud people for asylum. Root had to stop time, call in the retrieval squad, and do 4 memory wipes. A lot of police time wasted. All her fault. The commander took a form from his desk.
It's no use. I've made up my mind. I'm putting you on traffic and bringing in Corporal Frond.
Frond? Exploded Holly. She's a bimbo. An airhead. You can't make her the test case.
Root's face turned an even deeper shade of purple.
I can, and I will. Why shouldn't I? You have never given me your best. Either that, or your best just isn't good enough. Sorry, Short. You had your chance.
The commander turned back to his paperwork. The meeting was over. Holly could only stand there, aghast. She'd blown it. The best career opportunity she was ever likely to get, and she'd tossed it in the gutter. One mistake and her future was past. It wasn't fair. Holly felt an uncharacteristic anger take hold of her, but she swallowed it. This was no time to lose her temper.
Commander Root, sir, I feel I deserve one more chance.
Root didn't even look up from the paperwork.
And why is that?
Holly took a deep breath.
Because of my record, sir. It speaks for itself. Apart from the Hamburg thing, 10 successful recons, not a single memory wipe or time stop, apart from...
The Hamburg incident.
Completed Root. Holly took a chance.
If I were a male, one of your precious sprites, we wouldn't even be having this conversation.
Root glanced up sharply.
Now, just a minute, Captain Short.
He was interrupted by the bleeping of one of the phones on his desk. Then 2, then 3. A giant view screen crackled into life on the wall behind him. Root jabbed the speaker button, putting all his callers on conference.
Yes?
We've got a runner.
Root nodded.
Anything on Scopes?
Scopes was the shop name for the shrouded trackers attached to American communication satellites.
Yep, said Color 2. Big blip in Europe. Southern Italy. No shield.
Root cursed. An unshielded ferry could be seen by mortal eyes. That wasn't so bad if the perp was humanoid.
Classification?
Bad news, Commander, said the third caller. We got us a rogue troll.
Root rubbed his eyes.
Why did these things always happen on his watch?
Holly could understand his frustration. Trolls were the meanest of the deep tunnel creatures. They wandered the labyrinth, preying on anything unlucky enough to cross their path. Their tiny brains had no room for rules or restraint. Occasionally, one found its way into the shaft of a pressure elevator. Usually, the concentrated air currents fried them, but sometimes, one survived and was blasted to the surface. Driven crazy by pain and even the tiniest amounts of light, they would generally proceed to destroy everything in their path. Root shook his head rapidly, recovering himself.
Okay, Captain Short. Looks like you get your chance. You're running hot, I take it?
Yes, sir,
lied Holly, all too aware that Root would suspend her immediately if he knew she'd neglected the ritual.
Good. Then sign yourself on sidearm and proceed to the target area.
So I may or may not have joined a group called Final Fantasy 14. Mr. Polo. Oh.
Very nice. Very nice, Mr. B. Holly glanced at the view screens. Scopes were sending high-res shots of an Italian fortified town. A red dot was moving rapidly through the countryside toward the human population.
Do a thorough reconnaissance and report in. Do not attempt a retrieval. Is that understood?
Yes, sir,
We lost 6 men to troll attacks last quarter. 6 men. That was below ground, in familiar territory.
I understand, sir.
Root pursed his lips doubtfully.
Do you understand, Short? Do you really?
I think so, sir.
Have you ever seen what a troll can do to flesh and bone?
No, sir. Not up close.
Good. Let's not make today your first time.
Understood.
Root glared at her.
I don't know why it is, Captain. But whenever you start agreeing with me, I get decidedly nervous.
Root was right to be nervous. If he'd known how this straightforward recon assignment was going to turn out, he would probably have retired then and there. Tonight, history was going to be made. And it wasn't the discovery of radium, first man on the moon, happy kind of history. It was the Spanish Inquisition, here comes the Hindenburg, bad kind of history. Bad for humans and fairies. Bad for everyone.
Put the link in my SC Discord for my SC leader. He hates Lala's. Mr. Bolo, you troll.
And Holly's gonna hunt down trolls, so watch out, Mr. B.
Watch out.
Holly proceeded directly to the chutes. Her normally chatty mouth was a grim slash of determination. One chance. That was it. She would allow nothing to break her concentration. Excuse me. There was the usual line of holiday visa hopefuls stretching to the corner of Elevator Plaza, but Holly bypassed it by waving her badge at the waiting line. A truculent gnome refused to yield.
How come you LEP guys get to go cop topside? What's so special about you?
Holly breathed deeply through her nose. Courtesy at all times.
Police business, sir. Now, if you could just excuse me.
The gnome scratched his massive behind.
I hear you LEP guys make up your own police business just to get a look at some moonlight. That's what I hear.
Holly attempted an amused smile. What actually formed on her lips resembled a lemon-sucking grimace.
Whoever told you that is an idiot.
Sir,
recon only ventures above ground when absolutely necessary.
The gnome frowned. Obviously, he had made up the rumor himself, and suspected that Holly might have just called him an idiot. By the time he'd figured it out, she had skipped through the double doors. Foley was waiting for her in the ops. Foley was a paranoid centaur, convinced that human intelligence agencies were monitoring his transport and surveillance network. To prevent them from reading his mind, he wore a tinfoil hat at all times. He glanced up sharply when Holly entered through the pneumatic double doors.
Anybody see you come in here?
Holly thought about it.
The FBI, CIA, NSA, DEA, MI6, O, and the EIB.
Foley frowned.
The EIB? Everyone in the building.
Holly smirked. Foley rose from his swivel chair and clip-clopped over to her.
Oh, you're very funny in short. A regular riot. I thought the Hamburg incident might have knocked some of the cockiness out of you. If I were you, I'd concentrate on the job at hand.
Holly composed herself. He was right.
Okay, Foley, fill me in.
The centaur pointed to a live feed from the Eurosat, which was displayed on a large plasma screen.
This red dot is the troll. He's moving towards Martina Franca, a fortified town near the city of Brindisi. As far as we can tell, he stumbled onto Vint-D7. It was on cooldown after a surface shot. That's why the troll isn't crispy barbecue right now.
Holly grimaced. Charming, she thought.
We've been lucky in that our target has bumped into some food along the way. He chewed on a couple of cows for an hour or so that bought us a little bit of time.
I am changing my voice for him. This one's hard.
I think I'm gonna make his voice this one. Higher pitched, kind of gravelly. That'll work. This is fully now.
A couple of cows? Exclaimed Holly. Just how big is this fellow?
Foley adjusted his foil bonnet.
Bull troll. Fully grown. 180 kilos. With tusks like a wild boar. A really wild boar.
Holly swallowed. Suddenly, recon seemed a much better job than retrieval.
Right. What have you got for me?
Foley cantered across to the equipment table. He selected what looked like a rectangular wristwatch.
Locator. You find him, we find you. Routine stuff.
A video? The centaur clipped a small cylinder into the accommodating groove on Holly's helmet.
Live feed. Nuclear battery. No time limit. The mic is voice activated.
Good, said Holly. Brute said I should take a weapon on this one, just in case.
Way ahead of you,
said Foley. He picked a platinum handgun from the pile.
A Neutrino 2000. The latest model. Even the tunnel gangs don't have these. 3 settings, if you don't mind. Scorched, well done, and crisped to a cinder. Nuclear power source, too, so plug away. This baby will outlive you by 1,000 years.
All right, Paladin Mike. Thank you for stopping by. Glad you enjoyed the stream. Hopefully we'll see you around. Have a great night. Sleep well when you go to bed. And again, thank you for coming through. Holly strapped the lightweight weapon into her shoulder holster.
I'm ready, I think.
Foley chuckled.
I doubt it. No one's ever really ready for a troll.
Thanks for the confidence booster.
Confidence is ignorance,
advised the centaur.
If you're feeling cocky, it's because there's something you don't know.
Holly thought about arguing, but didn't. Maybe it was because she had a sneaking suspicion that Foley was right. The pressure elevators were powered by gaseous columns vented from the Earth's core. Zombie Pinata, thank you for the follow. Glad you're enjoying the stream thus far. Hope you continue to enjoy, and welcome to the dark side. How you doing tonight, zombie? Hopefully, Mr. B. Okay. The LEP Tech Boys, under Foley's guidance, had fashioned titanium eggs that could ride on the currents. They had their own independent motors, but for an express ride to the surface, there was nothing like the blast from a tidal flare. Foley led her past a long line of chute bays to E7. The pod sat in its clamp, looking very fragile to be rocketing about on magma streams. Its underside was charred black and pockmarked from shrapnel. The centaur slapped it fondly on a fender.
This baby's been in service for 50 years. Well, this model's still in the chutes.
Holly swallowed. The chutes made her nervous enough without riding in an antique.
When does it come offline?
Foley scratched his hairy belly.
With funding the way it is, not until we have us a fatality.
Holly cranked open the heavy door, the rubber seal yielding with a hiss. The pod was not built for comfort. There was barely enough space for a restraining seat among the jumble of electronics.
What's that?
Asked Holly, pointing at a grayish stain on the seat's headrest. Foley shuffled uncomfortably.
Brain fluid, I think. We had a pressure leak on the last mission, but that's plugged now. And the officer lived. down a few IQ points, but alive, and he can still take liquids.
Well, that's all right then, quipped Tolly, threading her way through the mass of wires. Foley strapped the harness onto her, checking the restraints thoroughly.
All set?
Holly nodded. Foley tapped her heimlet milk. Her heimlet milk, yes. Foley tapped her helmet mic.
Keep in touch,
he said, pulling the door closed behind him.
Don't think about it, Holly told herself. Don't think about the white-hot magma flow that's going to engulf this tiny craft. Don't think about hurtling toward the surface with a Mach 2 force trying to turn your inside out. And suddenly, don't think about the blood-crazed troll ready to disembowel you with his tusks. Nope, don't think about any of that stuff. Too late.
Pronunciation is important. I know. I'm really bad at pronunciation. Hamlet milk. Helmet Mike. Okay. Foley's vice.
I give up.
Okay. Foley's voice sounded through her earpiece.
T-minus 20,
he said.
We're on a secure channel in case the mud people have started underground monitoring. You never know. An oil tanker from the Middle East intercepted a transmission one time. What a mess that was.
Holly adjusted her helmet mic.
Focus, Foley. My life is in your hands here.
Okay, sorry. We're going to use the rail to drop you into E7's main shaft. There's a surge due any minute. That should see you past the first 100 clicks, then you're on your own.
Holly nodded, curling her fingers around the twin joysticks.
All systems check. Fire it up. There was a whoosh as the pod's engines ignited.
The tiny craft jostled in its housing, shaking Holly like a bead in a rattle. She could barely hear Foley speaking into her ear.
You're in the secondary shaft now. Get ready to fly, Short.
Hey, King John. I can't even pronounce people's names right. Hi, King John. How are you doing tonight? I remember this book. It's been years. Right? It's been quite a while for me, too, so I'm happy to be reading it again. Now if only I could learn to pronounce things properly. Excuse me. Holly pulled a rubber cylinder from the dash and slipped it between her teeth. No good having a radio if you've swallowed your tongue. She activated the external cameras and put the view on screen. The entrance to E7 was creeping toward her. The air was shimmering in the landing light's light glow. My god. Hiccups, please. The air was shimmering in the landing light glow. White-hot sparks tumbled into the secondary shaft. Holly couldn't hear the roar, but she could imagine it. A raw, skinning wind like a million trolls howling. Her fingers tightened around the joysticks. The pod shuddered to a halt at the lip. The chute stretched above and below. Massive. Boundless. Like dropping an ant down a drainpipe.
Righto,
crackled Foley.
Hang on to your breakfast. Roller coasters ain't got nothing on this.
Holly nodded. She couldn't speak. Not with the rubber in her mouth. The centaur would be able to see her in the pod cam anyway.
Sayonara, sweetheart,
said Foley. And pressed the button. The pod's clamp tilted, rolling Holly into the abyss. Her stomach tightened as G-force took hold, dragging her to the center of the Earth.
The seismology section had a million probes down here, with a 99.8 success rate at predicting the magma flares. But there was always that 0.2%. The fall seemed to last for an eternity. And just when Holly had mentally consigned herself to the scrap heap, she felt it. That unforgettable vibration. The feeling that outside her tiny sphere, the whole world was being shaken apart. Here it comes.
"Fins,"
she said, spitting the word around the cylinder. Foley may have replied, but she couldn't hear him anymore. Holly couldn't even hear herself, but she did see the stabilization fins slide out on the monitor. The flare caught her like a hurricane, spinning the pod at first until the fins caught. Half-melted rocks pelted the craft's underside, jolting it toward the chute walls. Holly compensated with bursts from the joysticks. The heat was tremendous in the confined space, enough to fry a human. But fairy lungs are made of stronger stuff. The acceleration dragged at her body with invisible hands, stretching the flesh over her arms and face. Holly blinked salty sweat from her eyes and concentrated on the monitor. The flare had totally engulfed her pod, and was a big one, too. 4-7 at the very least. A good 1,000-foot girth. Orange-striped magma swirled and hissed around her, searching for a weak point in the metal casing. The pod groaned and complained, 50-year-old rivets threatening to pop. Holly shook her head. The first thing she was going to do on her routine was kick Foley straight in the hairy behind. She felt like a nut inside a shell between a gnome's molars. Doomed. A bow plate buckled, popped in as though punched by a giant fish. Giant fist. Not a fish. A fist. Mr. Polo Plus. I just remembered a name that brings me mental pain was in this book. What name is that, King John? Where's Fist? Okay. The pressure light blinked on. Holly could feel her head being squeezed. The eyes would be the first to go, popping like ripe berries. I don't know, Ray. Fish punches are pretty devastating. Oh, really, Holly? Holly brings you mental pain? I'm curious. Look on the bright side, you haven't said anything bad yet. True facts. Very true facts. She checked the dials. 20 more seconds before she rode out the flare and was running on thermals. Those 20 seconds seemed like an age. Holly sealed the helmet to protect her eyes, riding out the final barrage of rocks. And suddenly, they were clear, sailing upward on the comparatively gentle spirals of hot air. Holly added her own thrusters to the upward force. No time to waste floating around on the wind. Above her, a circle of neon lights marked the docking zone. Holly swiveled horizontal and pointed the docking nodes at the light. This was delicate. Many recon pilots had made it this far, only to miss the port and lose valuable time. Not Holly. She was a natural. First in the academy. She gave the thrusters one final squeeze and coasted the last 100 feet. Using the rudders beneath her feet, she teased the pod through the circle of light and into its clamp on the landing pad. The nodes resolved, settling into their grooves. Safe. Okay.
Hello, Build. How are you doing tonight? My girlfriend Holly right now, her like,
oh, that sucks, John. I'm sorry. I'm sorry to hear that.
Excuse me.
Okay. Holly smacked herself on the chest, releasing the safety harness. Once the door seal was opened, sweet surface air flooded the cabin. There was nothing like that first breath after a ride in the chutes. She breathed deeply, purging the stale pod air from her lungs. How had the people ever left the surface? Sometimes she wished that her ancestors had stayed to fight it out with the mud people. But there were too many of them. Unlike fairies, who could produce only a single child every 20 years, mud people bred like rodents. Numbers would subdue even magic. Although she was enjoying the night air, Holly could taste traces of pollutants. The mud people destroyed everything they came into contact with. Of course, they didn't live in the mud anymore. Not in this country, at least. Oh, no. Big, fancy dwellings with rooms for everything. Rooms for sleeping, rooms for eating, even a room to go to the toilet. Indoors. Holly shuddered. Imagine going to the toilet inside your own house. Disgusting. The only good thing about going to the toilet was the minerals being returned to the earth. But the mud people had even managed to botch that up by treating the stuff with bottles of blue chemicals. If anyone had told her 100 years ago that humans would be taking the fertile out of fertilizer, she would have told them to get some air holes drilled into their skull. But I can overlook it. It is a book, after all. True facts, true facts. Are you sick of me calling you Billy? Dear God. So is that the kind of chair? Yeah, this is my chair. This is my Papasan chair. And it's breaking. And I'm very sad. But this is my wonderful, wonderful Papasan comfy corner chair. Just saw a funny bar sign on Facebook. We do not serve women. You must bring your own. Oh, God. Dear God, Mr. Bolo. That's kind of funny. That is pretty funny, though. Okay. Holly unhooked a set of wings from their bracket. They were double ovals with a clunky motor. She moaned. Dragonflies. She hated that model. Gas engine, if you believe it, and heavier than a pig dipped in mud. Now, the Hummingbird Z7, that was transport. Whisper silent, with a satellite-bounced solar battery that could fly you twice around the world. But there were budget cuts again. On her wrist, the locator began to beep. She was in range. Holly stepped out of the pod and onto the landing bay. She was inside a camouflaged mound of earth, commonly known as a fairy fort. Indeed, the people used to live in these until they were driven deeper underground. There wasn't much technology, just a few external monitors and a self-destruct device should the bay be discovered. I'm here for Delurnmon. Huh? Oh, hi, Lunar. How's it going? About to play some Carball. There you go, Shadow. Enjoy that. Enjoy the Carballs. How you doing tonight, Lunar? Also, how are you doing tonight, Shadow? I don't know if I said that earlier. I'm gonna need to get a drink in a minute. My throat is getting seriously dry. There was nothing on the screens. All clear. The pneumatic doors were slightly askew where the troll had barged through, but otherwise, everything seemed operational. Holly strapped on the wings, stepping into the outside world. The Italian night sky was crisp and brisk, infused with olives and vines. Crickets clicked in the rough grass, and moths fluttered in the starlight. Holly couldn't stop herself smiling. It was worth the risk. Every bit of it. Speaking of risk, she checked the locator. The bip was much stronger now. The troll was almost at the town walls. She could appreciate nature after the mission was over. Now it was time for action. some Wawa. Hey! I remember, how do I... Kaysen? You've been here before. I'm almost positive of it. Maybe not. But hi, how are you? How are you doing tonight? Your name just looks really familiar. Also, C4 is an awesome shortening of that of your name. Not gonna lie. Okay. C4 Sin. Okay. Or skin. I will sit here in the background. I have some shit going on over the phone. Alright, John. I said hey to you earlier, and you didn't say hey back on stream. On Steam. Oh, on Steam. Okay. Gotta love them Steam notifications. Okay. It's a bad joke on C4 skin. Like force. Oh. Oh. I get it. Okay. Well, C4, how are you doing tonight? Also, Lunar, get a blankie because it's cold. Holly primed the wing's motor, pulling the starter cord over her shoulder. Nothing. She fumed silently. Every spoiled kid in Haven had a hummingbird for their winter holiday, wilderness holidays, and here were the LEP with wings that were junk when they were new. She yanked the cord again, and then again. On the third wrench, it caught, spewing a stream of smoke and fumes into the night. About time, she grunted, flicking the throttle wide open. The wings flapped their way up to a steady beat, and with not a little effort, lifted Captain Holly short into the night sky. Yeah, a lot of things take me a minute to get, Mr. B. Doing good. No astronomy class tomorrow. Nice. I got one, and sockies, and two sweatpants, and a shirt over my hoodie. Oh, goodness. It sounds so cold, Lunar. If you're still cold, get, like, a warm drink or something. I'm concerned now. Even without the locator... Oh, the Cruisinator! Thank you for the follow. Glad you're enjoying the stream thus far. Hope you continue to enjoy, and welcome to the dark side. How you doing tonight, Cruisinator? Excuse me. Goddamn. Catch up on the book really quick. We're reading first Artemis Fowl book. We're on chapter 3. Currently, what's happened so far is Artemis is a 12-year-old criminal mastermind, genius, and he has gotten pictures of a copy of the fairy book, which is the rule book for fairies, and in order to get himself some gold, because his father kind of put his family's fortune in jeopardy, got himself captured, which we don't have a lot of history on yet, just a few paragraphs worth, but Artemis is trying to basically bring back the family fortune. He managed to figure out the translation for the book, and then we switched over to the viewpoint of Captain Holly Short, who is an elf, which falls under the fairy category, and specifically she's a leprechaun, which is her job, which is part of the LEP, Lower Elements Police, LEP Recon, so that's a play off of leprechaun, There was a big nasty troll that managed to make it to the surface where humans live. Fairies live underground. And the troll managed to get up there into an area in Italy, and Holly is going to get some reconnaissance so that people can, so that other fairies, the LEP excuse me, LEP retrieval can get the troll and bring it back to underground where the fairies are. Yeah. That's basic synopsis of what has happened thus far. So. Popcorn. Yummy. I'm glad to hear you're doing well, Chris. Got some noms and milkies. Awesome, Lunar. I'm gonna get popcorn soon, though. Popcorn is amazing. I want popcorn now. But I don't feel like making popcorn, because I'm lazy. Not a problem, C4. Okay. Even without the locator, the troll would have been easy to follow. It had left a trail of destruction wider than a tunnel excavator. Holly flew low, skipping between mist hazes and trees, matching the troll's course. The crazed creature had cut a swath through the middle of a vineyard, turned a stone wall to rubble, and left a guard dog gibbering under a hedge. Then she flew over the cows. It was not a pretty sight. Without going into details, let's just say there wasn't much left besides horns and hooves. The red bip was louder now. Louder meant closer. She could see the town below her, nestled on top of a low hill, surrounded by a crenellated wall from the Middle Ages. Lights still burned in most windows. Time for a little magic. A lot of the magic attributed to the people is just superstition, but they do have certain powers. Healing, the mesmer, the shield, and shielding among them. Shielding is really a misnomer. What fairies actually do is vibrate at such a high frequency that they are never in one place long enough to be seen. Humans may notice a slight shimmer in the air if they are paying close attention, which they rarely are, and even then the shimmer is generally attributed to evaporation. Typical of mud people to invent a complicated explanation for a simple phenomenon. So I understand, and smiles. Mm-hmm. Yep. Makes sense. Keeps nodding. Oh, about the book. Holly switched on her shield. It took a bit more out of her than usual. She could feel the strain in the beads of sweat on her forehead. I really should complete the ritual, she thought. The sooner the better. Some commotion below broke into her thoughts. Something that didn't gel with the nighttime noises. Holly adjusted the trim on her backpack and flew in for a closer look. Look only, she reminded herself. That was her job. A recon officer was sent up the chutes to pinpoint the target, while the retrieval boys took a nice, cushy shuttle. The troll was directly below her, pounding against the town's outer wall, which was coming away in chunks beneath his powerful fingers. Holly sucked in a startled gasp. This guy was a monster. Big as an elephant, and 10 times as mean. But this particular beast was worse than mean. He was scared. Control, said Holly into her mic. Run and locate it. Situation critical, topside. Root himself was on the other end of the comlink.
Clarify, Captain.
Holly pointed her video link at the troll. This is the first Artemis Fowl book, actually. I do have the entire series. I own the entire series, and we may end up going through all of them. I don't know. It kind of depends on you guys. If you're not tired of the story by then. But yeah, this is the very first Artemis Fowl book. Runner is going through the town wall. Contact imminent.
Computer tried to go to sleep on me for a second.
Contact imminent. How far away is retrieval?
ETA 5 minutes minimum. We're still in the shuttle.
Holly bit her lip. Root was in the shuttle? That's too long, Commander. The whole town is going to explode in 10 seconds. I'm going in.
Negative, Holly. Captain Short. You don't have an invite. You know the law. Hold your position.
But Commander...
Root cut her off. No! No buts, Captain. Hang back. That's an order.
Holly's entire body felt like a heartbeat. Gasoline fumes were addling her brain. What could she do? What was the right decision to make? Lives? Or orders?
Oh no, Mr. Bolo.
Oh yes, this is a new book in the sense that we finished the last book last time. The Dragon Spell book. So yes, this is a new Comfy Corner book. Holly's entire body felt like a heartbeat. Gasoline fumes were addling her brain. What could she do? What was the right decision to make? Lives or orders? Then, the troll broke through the wall, and a child's voice split the night.
Ayuda!
It screamed. Help. An invitation. At a stretch. Sorry, Commander. The troll is light crazy, and there are children in there. She could imagine Root's face, purple with rage, as he spat into the mic.
I'll have your stripes, Short! You'll spend the next 100 years on drain duty!
But it was no use. Holly had disconnected her mic and swooped in after the troll. Streamlining her body, Captain Short ducked into the hole. She appeared to be in a restaurant. A packed restaurant. The troll had been temporarily blinded by the electric light and was thrashing about in the center of the floor. The patrons were stunned. Even the child's plea had petered out. They sat gaping, party hats perched comically on their heads. Waiters froze, huge trays of pasta quivering on their splayed fingers. Chubby Italian infants covered their eyes with chubby fingers. It was always like this in the beginning, the shocked silence. Then came the screaming. A wine bottle crashed to the floor. It broke the spell. The pandemonium started. Holly winced. Trolls hated noise almost as much as light. The troll lifted massive, shaggy shoulders, its retractable claws sliding out with an ominous shh. Classic predator behavior. The beast was about to strike. Holly drew her weapon and flicked it up to the second setting. She couldn't kill the troll under any circumstances, not to save humans, but she could certainly put him out until retrieval arrived. Aiming for the weak point at the base of the skull, she let the troll have a long burst of the concentrated ion ray. The beast staggered, stumbled a few steps, then got very angry.
It's okay, thought Holly. I'm shielded, invisible. To any onlookers, it would seem as though the pulsating blue beam emanated from thin air.
The troll rounded on her, its muddy dreadlocks swinging like candles.
No panic. It can't see me.
The troll picked up a table. Invisible. Totally invisible. He pulled back a shaggy arm and let fly.
Just a slight shimmer in the air.
The table tumbled straight toward her head. Holly moved, a second too late.
Excuse me.
The table clipped her backpack, knocking the gas tank clean off. It spun through the air, trailing flammable fluid. Italian restaurants, wouldn't you know it, full of candles. The tank twirled right through an elaborate candelabrum and burst into flames, like some deadly framework. Most of the gas landed on the troll. So did Holly. The troll could see her. There was no doubt about it. It squinted at her through the hated light, its brow a rictus of pain and fear. Her shield was off. Her magic was gone. Holly twisted in the troll's grip, but it was useless. The creature's fingers were the size of bananas, but nowhere near as pliant. They were squashing the breath from her ribcage with savage ease. Needle-like claws were scraping at the toughened material of her uniform. Any second now, they would punch through, and that would be that. Holly couldn't think. The restaurant was a carousel of chaos. The troll was gnashing its tusks, greasy molars trying to grip her helmet. Holly could smell its fetid breath through her filters. She could smell the odor of burning fur, too, as the fire spread along the troll's back. The beast's green tongue rasped against her visor, slamming the lower section. The visor! That was it. Her only chance. Holly wormed her free hand to the helmet controls. The tunnel lights. High beams. She depressed the sunken button, and 800 watts of unfiltered light blasted from the twin spotlights above her eyes. The troll reared back, a penetrating scream exploding from beneath rows of teeth. Dozens of glasses and bottles shattered where they stood. It was too much for the poor beast. Stunned, set on fire, and now blinded. The shock and pain made their way through to its tiny brain, ordering it to shut down. The troll complied, keeling over with almost comical stiffness. Holly rolled to avoid a scything tusk. There was complete silence, but for tinkling glass, crackling fur, and the sudden release of breath. Holly climbed shakily to her feet. There were a lot of eyes following her. Human eyes. She was 100% visible. And these humans wouldn't stay complacent for long. This breed never did. Containment was the issue. She raised her empty palms, a gesture of peace.
Scusatemi tutti,
she said, the language flowing easily from her tongue. The Italians, ever graceful, muttered that it was nothing. Holly reached slowly into her pocket and withdrew a small sphere. She placed it in the middle of the floor.
Guardate,
she said. Look. The restaurant's patrons complied, leaning in to see the small silver ball. It was ticking, faster and faster, almost like a countdown. Holly turned her back to the sphere. 3, 2, 1. Boom! Flash! Mass unconsciousness. Nothing fatal, but headaches all around in about 40 minutes. Holly sighed. Safe. For the moment. She ran to the door and slid the latch across. Nobody was going in or out. Except through the big gaping hole in the wall. Next, she doused the smoldering troll with the contents of the restaurant's fire extinguisher, hoping the icy powder wouldn't revive the sleeping behemoth. Holly surveyed the mess she had created. There was no doubt. It was a shambles. Worse than Hamburg. Root would skin her alive. She'd rather face the troll any day. This was the end of her career, for sure. But suddenly, that didn't seem so important, because her ribs were aching, and she had a blinder of a pressure headache coming on. Perhaps a rest, just for a second, so she could pull herself together before retrieval showed up. Holly didn't even bother looking for a chair. She simply allowed her legs to buckle beneath her, sinking to the chessboard linoleum floor.
Well, the phone call was deep, but don't. Girl is in the way of reading.
Oh, but don't let that get in the way of reading. Probably wasn't going to, but I feel I had to say it. Aw, no worries. Oh, goodness. everything okay, John? Hopefully. Waking up to Commander Root's bulging features is the stuff of nightmares. Holly's eyes flickered open, and for a second she could have sworn that there was concern in those eyes. But then it was gone, replaced by the customary vein-popping fury.
Captain Short!
He roared, mindless of her headache.
What in the name of sanity happened here?
Holly rose shakily to her feet. The sentences just wouldn't come.
You disobeyed a direct order. I told you to hang back. You know it's forbidden to enter a human building without an invitation.
Holly shook the shadows from her vision.
I got invited in.
A child called for help.
You're on shaky ground there, Short.
There is precedent, sir. Corporal Rowe versus the state. The jury ruled that the trapped woman's cry for help could be accepted as an invitation into the building. Anyway, you're all here now. That means you accepted the invitation too.
Said Root doubtfully.
I suppose you were lucky. Things could have been worse.
Holly looked around. Things couldn't have been a lot worse. The establishment was pretty trashed, and there were 40 humans out for the count. The tech boys were attaching mind-wipe electrodes to the temples of unconscious diners.
We managed to secure the area, in spite of half the town hammering on the door.
What about the hole?
Root smirked.
See for yourself.
Holly glanced over. Retrieval had jimmied a hologram, leading to the existing electricity slot. Retrieval had jimmied a hologram led into the existing electricity sockets and were projecting an unbattered wall over the hole. The holograms were handy for quick patches, but no good under scrutiny. Anyone who examined the wall too closely would have noticed that the slightly transparent patch was exactly the same as the stretch behind it. In this case, there were two identical patches of spiderweb cracks and two reproductions of the same Rembrandt. But the people inside the pizzeria were in no condition to examine walls, and by the time they woke up, the wall would have been repaired by the telekinetic division, and the entire paranormal experience would be removed from the memories.
Yes, Bild, we are. Not tonight. It'll be over the course of a few streams. But we'll be going through the entire book. And then possibly go on to the next. It kind of depends on what people want.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that, John.
Excuse me.
A retrieval officer bolted from the restroom.
Commander!
Yes, Sergeant?
There's a human in here, sir. The concussor didn't reach him. He's coming, sir. Right now, sir.
Shields!
Barked Root.
Everyone!
Holly tried. She really did. But it wouldn't come. Her magic was gone. A toddler waddled out of the bathroom, his eyes heavy with sleep. He pointed a pudgy finger directly at Holly.
Ciao, Folletta.
He said, before climbing into his father's lap to continue his snooze. Root shimmered back into the visible spectrum. He was, if possible, even angrier than before.
What happened to your shield, Short?
Holly swallowed.
Stress, Commander?
She offered hopefully. Root wasn't having any of it.
You lied to me, Captain. You're not running hot at all, are you?
Holly shook her head mutely.
How long since you completed the ritual?
Holly chewed her lip.
I'd say about 4 years, sir.
Root nearly popped a vein.
Four years? It's a wonder you lasted this long. Do it now. Tonight. You are not coming below ground again without your powers. You're a danger to yourself and your fellow officers.
Yes, sir.
Get a set of hummingbirds from retrieval and zip across to the old country. There's a full moon tonight.
Yes, sir.
And don't think I've forgotten about this shambles. We'll talk about it when you get back.
Yes, sir. Very good, sir. Holly turned to go, but Root cleared his throat for attention.
Oh, and Captain Short?
Yes, sir. Root's face had lost its purple tinge. He almost seemed embarrassed.
Well done, on the whole life-saving thing. Could have been worse. An awful lot worse.
Holly beamed behind her visor. Perhaps she wouldn't be kicked out of Recon after all. Thank you, sir. Root grunted, his complexion returning to its normal ruddy hue.
Now get out of here, and don't come back until you fall to the tip of your ears with magic!
Holly sighed. So much for gratitude. Yes, sir. On my way, sir. Okay, we're gonna take a quick break for me to go to the bathroom and get another drink, and then we will be right back to continue with a bit more of the book. I figure we'll get at least one more chapter done tonight, so. Yeah, we'll go on a quick break. Oh. And get you some nice soft, or some nice, music. Well, do. Oh, there's a lot more songs in here than I thought. We'll do this one. If you're interested in the music that I'm currently playing, got it right here for you.
Okay, I'm back. I have cheese and tea, so that's pretty awesome. Oh no! Mr. B, all your scales! What's even going on? What's going on in chat? Went deaf in your left ear recently? I'm partially deaf in my left ear because of my car accident a year ago. Revlo is my wife. So accident prone. I understand that feel. Oh, I haven't switched back over to... There we go. All right, tea and a few cheese cubes. I am happy. I need words read in various accents. Are you talking about my reading? Because you will get that as soon as I finish my last 4-5 cheese cubes. Cheese! Cheese is wonderful. I love it. Here you go, Mr. B. Kojak cheese cubes. I have a mild obsession. Yep.
Thank you, Lunar.
Thank you.
Ray, yay, Ray.
Oh, that's so sad, Mr. Bolo.
It's like the most depressing thing ever.
Okay.
Alright, let's read one more chapter. How many chapters does this book have? It doesn't have a table of contents. Okay. Chapters are just so dang long.
Wait, are you kidding me?
Oh my god, it's got 9 chapters and an epilogue. That's how long the chapters are. I guess that makes sense, because we've read a total of 3 chapters, and we're on page 62, so...
Yes, Lunar. There you go. Also, it's nice and warm in my room because I have a space heater.
So worth it. It is absolutely so worth it.
Yes, Lunar is an Umbreon. Essentially. For all intents and purposes. Read faster, we have to... I'm not reading this entire book tonight. That's... 279 pages. That's so much. So much. It's nice and warm in the office because my computer is a space heater. Nice. Very nice.
Umbreon number 1.
Okay. Chapter 4. Wait, let me see where chapter 4 ends. With as long as these are. Okay, that's not too bad. Chapter 4. Abduction. Is that all? Normally, I would be, like, fully... all about reading this entire book in one night. I cannot do so out loud. It will wreck my voice so hard. Still less pages than a medical manual.
I'm glad your music is awesome, Mr. B. Aw, that sucks, Lunar.
Remember, medical manuals can save lives. Do it. No. No. I can't. Please don't make me. I don't want to wreck my voice. I like my voice. For the most part. Alright. Chapter 4. Abduction. Great. Artemis's main problem was one of location. How to locate a leprechaun. This was one sly bunch of fairies, hanging around for God knows how many millennia, and still not one photo, not one frame of video, not even a Loch Ness-type hoax. They weren't exactly a sociable group, and they were smart, too. No one had ever got their hands on fairy gold. But no one had ever had access to the book, either. And puzzles were so simple when you had the key. Artemis had summoned Artemis had summoned the butlers to his study, and spoke to them now from a mini lectern. There are certain rituals every fairy must complete to renew his magic. Excuse me.
Nice build. I have no other plans. I'm sorry, Kiwi. Can I save you from being shot? Wear it like body armor. Oh, God. Butler and Juliet nodded, as though this were a normal briefing. Artemis flicked through his hard copy of the book and selected a passage. From the earth thine power flows, given through courtesy, so thanks are owed. Pluck thou the magic seed, where full moon, ancient oak, and twisted water meet, and bury it far from where it was found, so return your gift into the ground. Artemis closed the text. Do you see? Butler and Juliet kept nodding while still looking thoroughly mystified. Artemis sighed. The leprechaun is bound by certain rituals. Very specific rituals, I might add. We can use them to track one down. Juliet raised a hand, even though she herself was 4 years Artemis's senior. Yes?
Well, the thing is, Artemis, she said hesitantly, twisting a strand of blonde hair in a way that several of the local louts considered extremely attractive. The bit about leprechauns.
Artemis frowned. It was a bad sign.
Your point, Juliet?
Well, leprechauns, you know they're not real, don't you? Butler winced. It was his fault, really. He'd never got around to filling in his sister on the mission parameters. Artemis scowled reprovingly at him.
Butler hasn't already talked to you about this.
No, was he supposed to?
Yes, he certainly was. Perhaps he thought you'd laugh at him.
Butler squirmed. That was exactly what he'd thought. Juliet was the only person alive who laughed at him with embarrassing regularity. Most other people did it once. Just once. Artemis cleared his throat.
Let us proceed under the assumption that the fairy folk do exist and that I am not a gibbering moron.
Never heard of this book. Alright, John, sleep well. I understand that feel. Even if it's just a matter of want to go to sleep, or rather should go to sleep, but want to listen to the book being continued, don't want to fall asleep no matter how relaxing the book is. I'm gender fluid / non-binary. Play Graven. Okay. Butler nodded weakly. Juliet was unconvinced.
Human. Yes, that is a very good answer. Human. Identify as human. Bugger off. Alright.
Very well. Now, as I was saying, the people have to fulfill a special ritual to renew their powers. According to my interpretation, they must pick a seed from an ancient oak tree by a bend in a river. And they must do this during the full moon.
The light began to dawn in Butler's eyes.
So, all we have to do is run a cross-reference through the weather satellites, which I already have. Believe it or not, there aren't that many ancient oaks left, if you take ancient to be 100 years plus. When you factor in the river bend in full moon, there are precisely 129 sites to be surveyed in this country.
Lala fell. There you go.
couple.
Butler grinned. Stake out. Now the master was talking his language.
There are preparations to be made for our guest's arrival, said Artemis, handing a typewritten sheet of A4 to Juliet. These alterations must be made to the cellar. See to it, Juliet. To the letter.
Yes, Artie.
Artemis frowned, but only slightly. For reasons that he couldn't quite fathom, he didn't mind terribly when Juliet called him by the pet name his mother usually had for him, by the pet name his mother had for him. Butler scratched his chin thoughtfully. Artemis noticed the gesture.
Question? Well, Artemis, the sprite in Hosi Ming City.
Artemis nodded.
Iaki, thank you for the follow. Glad you're enjoying the stream thus far. Hope you continue to enjoy, and welcome to the dark side.
In a narrator's voice.
And so it began. Build Night Watch Ray Reed. It was a wonderful time as Ray read aloud the book.
How you doing tonight, Iaki? Okay.
Artemis nodded. I know. Why didn't we simply adopt her?
Yes, sir.
According to Chi Lun's Almanac of the People, a 7th century manuscript recovered from the lost city of Sushanmo, once a fairy has taken spirits with the mud people, that's us, by the way, they are forever dead to their brothers and sisters. So there is no guarantee that that particular fairy was even worth an ounce of gold. No, my old friend, we need fresh blood. All clear.
Isig is charging. I may snap. Oh, you can make it, Kiwi. That moment when your neck pop is so satisfying that you just sit still and sigh after the pop.
I know that feel. It is wonderful. Tired? Late? Yeah, I get that. It's almost 3 a.m. for me.
Okay.
No, my old friend. We need fresh blood. All clear?
Butler nodded.
Good. Now, there are several items you will need to procure for our moonlight jaunts.
Butler scanned the sheet. Basic field equipment.
Shadow TF, thank you for the host. I appreciate that support and you sharing me with your followers and viewers. Thank you very much, Shadow.
Okay. Butler scanned the sheet. Basic field equipment. A few eyebrow razors, nothing too puzzling until...
Sunglasses? At night?
When Artemis smiled, as he did now, one almost expected vampire fangs to sprout by his gums.
Yes, Butler. Sunglasses. Trust me.
It is a song that a friend sent to me, like a couple years ago. And I haven't been able to find it on YouTube or anything. Not even Tumblr. But it's called, The Date Song. And it's actually really super cute. That's just, like, the very beginning of it. Here, I can actually play it. Maybe, if it decides to play. Oh, no.
Hey, so, I was maybe wondering if hopefully as possibly you'd like to go out with me this week. Or maybe on the weekend you should see it doesn't matter as long as we're together, so to speak. Honestly, if you asked me out, I'd say yes in a heartbeat. Honestly, I really like you and I think that we should meet. I was thinking maybe dinner or a movie if you're four, but I guess really anything goes. So answer yes or no, or maybe, maybe it's just a little shady. It's all good, I thought I'd let you know. You know, I think we could be more. I guess it all just depends, but if not, that's still cool, you know. I'm always down for just friends. Yeah, totally.
There it goes. No, I haven't even, I don't know that I don't remember if I've tried a lyric search or not. Slayer date song? Maybe. I don't know. I don't know if that was a joke or what.
Okay. Yes, butler. Sunglasses. Trust me.
And butler did. Implicitly. Holly activated the thermal coil in her suit and climbed to 13,000 feet. The hummingbird wings were top of the range. The battery readout showed 4 red bars, more than enough for a quick jaunt through mainland Europe and across the British Isles. Of course, the regulations said always travel over water if possible, but Holly could never resist knocking the snowcap from the highest alp on her way past. The suit protected Holly from the worst of the elements, but she could still feel the chill sinking into her bones. The moon seemed huge from this altitude, the craters on its surface easily distinguishable. Tonight, it was a perfect sphere. A magical full moon. Immigration would have their hands full, as thousands of Surface 6 ferries were drawn irresistibly overground. A large percentage would make it, probably causing mayhem if their revelry Earth's mantle is riddled with illegal tunnels, and it was impossible to police them all. Holly followed the Italian coast up to Monaco, and from there, across the Alps to France. She loved flying. All fairies did. According to the book, they had once been equipped with wings of their own, but evolution had stripped them of this power.
Oh, my favorite music is by OMFG. It's called Hello. Interesting. I'm joking. Okay.
Oh, joking. Okay, got it. All but the sprites. One school of thought believed that the people were descended from airborne dinosaurs, possibly pterodactyls. Much of the upper body's skeletal structure was the same. This theory would certainly explain the tiny nub of bone on each shoulder blade. Holly toyed with the idea of visiting Disneyland Paris. The LEP had several undercover operatives stationed there, most of them working in the Snow White exhibit. It was one of the few places on Earth where the people could pass unnoticed. But if some tourist got a photo of her and it ended up on the internet, Root would have her badge for sure. With a sigh of regret, she passed over the shower of multicolored fireworks below. Once across the channel, Holly flew low, skipping over the white-crested waves. She called out to the dolphins, and they rose to the surface, leaping from the water to match her pace. She could see the pollution in them, bleaching their skin white, and giving them red sores on their backs. And although she smiled, her heart was breaking. Mud people had a lot to answer for. Finally, the coast loomed ahead of her. The old country, I think it's pronounced Ire. Yeah. Oops. Ah! Getting tangled in my headphones. It's spelled weirdly, but if I think of it from the Luck of the Irish movie, Ear, or something like that. The land where time began, the most magical place on the planet. It was here, 10,000 years ago, that the ancient fairy race, the Dee Danann,
had battled against the demon Formorians, carving the famous Giant's Causeway with the strength of their magical blasts. It was here that the Lea Fiel stood, the rock at the center of the universe, where fairy kings and later the human Ardri were crowned. It was also here, unfortunately, that the Mud People were most in tune with magic, which resulted in a far higher people sighting rate than you got anywhere else on the planet. Thankfully, the rest of the world assumed that the Irish were crazy, a theory that the Irish themselves did nothing to debunk. They had somehow got it into their heads that each fairy lugs around a pot of gold with him wherever he went. While it was true that LAP had a ransom fund because of its officer's high-risk occupation, no human had ever taken a chunk of it yet. This didn't stop the Irish population in general from skulking around rainbows, hoping to win the supernatural lottery. But in spite of all that, if there was one race the people felt an affinity for, it was the Irish. Perhaps it was their eccentricity. Perhaps it was their dedication to the Craic, as they called it. And if the people were actually related to humans, as another theory had it, odds are that the Emerald Isle was where it started. Holly punched up a map on her wrist locator and set it to sweep for magical hotspots. The best site would obviously be Tara, near the Lea Fiel, but on a night like tonight, every traditionalist fairy with an overground pass would be dancing around the holy scene, so best to give it a miss. There was a secondary site, not far from here, just off the southeast coast. Easy access from the air, but remote and desolate for landbound humans. Holly reined in the throttle and descended to 90 yards. She skipped over a bristling evergreen forest, emerging in a moonlit meadow. A silver thread of river bisected the field, and there, nestling in the fold of a meander loop, was the proud oak. Did I say infinity? I meant affinity. My pronunciation, I'm so sorry. I am drinking Arizona green tea with ginseng and honey. I got it in cans because it tends to go bad when I get it in the big bottle, like the big gallon bottle. I don't drink through it fast enough, so it tends to go nasty. So I got the cans this time around in hopes that it'll last longer. But I'm drinking through those pretty quickly, to be perfectly honest. Okay. Holly checked her locator for life forms. Once she judged the cow 2 fields over not to be a threat, she cut her engines and glided to the foot of the mighty tree. Hand hugs?
Huggies.
Kiwis and Spartans. Don't steal my chair. It is a wonderful chair. The artist never released the song title. And it is unfindable. Oh, the date song thing? Yeah. It's really hard. I don't even know the artist's name. I just know that in my computer it's called the date song. But I don't know, like, anything else about it. I have no clue how my friend got it. He just gave it to me, and I was like, aw, this is super cute. Provides Luna with virtual air hug.
Oh!
Treasure that. Treasure that, Luna. Hand hugs, raise hand hugs. Okay. 4 months of stakeout. Even Butler, the consummate professional, was beginning to dread the long nights of dampness and insect bites. Thankfully, the moon was not full every night. It was always the same. They would crouch in their foil-lined blind in complete silence, Butler repeatedly checking his equipment, while Artemis stared unblinkingly through the eye of the scope.
I will send it to you through Discord, Shadow. After stream. Hey, Solix. I am very confused what you're talking about, Solix. Okay. At times like these, nature seemed deafening in their confined space. Butler longed to whistle, to make conversation, anything to break the unnatural silence. But Artemis's concentration was absolute. He would brook no interference or lapse of focus. This was business. Tonight they were in the southeast, the most inaccessible site yet. Butler had been forced to make 3 trips to the jeep in order to hump the equipment across a stile, a bog, and 2 fields. His boots and trousers were ruined, and now he would have to sit in the blind with ditch water soaking into the seat of his pants. Artemis had somehow contrived to remain spotless. The blind was ingenious in design, and interest had already been expressed in the manufacturing rights, mostly by military representatives. But Artemis had resolved to sell the patent to a sporting goods multinational. It was constructed of an elasticated foil polymer on a multi-hinged fiberglass skeleton. Mr. Bullough, can you permit Shadow, please? Oh, no, I wasn't rubbing it. I was probably adjusting it to move it. It's a quieter level speaking. And then it's not as big as like actually going to an ASMR channel on YouTube. But it's still kind of the relaxing idea. And I do some sounds with, like, the book occasionally. Actually, Shadow, if you hit... There we go. That works. If Shadow found it, I need to capture the link.
Sweet.
Found it on Tumblr too? Nice. I just had a really hard time finding it, so... Thank you, Shadow. Okay. Okay. The blind was ingenious in design, and interest had already been expressed in the manufacturing rights, mostly by military representatives, but Artemis had resolved to sell the patent to a sporting goods multinational. It was constructed of an elasticated foil polymer on a multi-hinged fiberglass skeleton. The foil, similar to that used by NASA, trapped the heat inside the structure while preventing the camouflaged outside surface from overheating. This ensured that any animals sensitive to heat would be unaware of its presence. The hinges meant that the blind would move almost like a liquid, filling whatever depression it was dropped into. Instant shelter and vantage point. You simply place the Velcroed bag in a hole and pull the string. But all the cleverness in the world couldn't improve the atmosphere. Something was troubling Artemis. It was plain in the web of premature lines that spread from the corners of his deep blue eyes.
Good job, Lunar.
After several nights of fruitless surveillance, Butler plucked up enough courage to ask,
Artemis,
he began hesitantly.
I realize it's not my place, but I know there's something wrong, and if there's anything I can do to help...
Artemis didn't speak for several moments, and for those few moments, Butler saw the face of a young boy. The boy Artemis might have been. It's my mother, Butler, he said at last. I'm beginning to wonder if she'll ever... Then the proximity alarm flashed red. Holly hooked the wings over a low branch, unstrapping the helmet to give her ears some air. You had to be careful with elfin ears. A few hours in the helmet and they started to flake. She gave the tips a massage. No dry skin there. That was because she had a daily moisturizing regime, not like some of the male LEP officers. When they took off their helmets, you'd swear it had just started to snow. Holly paused for a minute to admire the view. Ireland certainly was picturesque. Even the mud people hadn't been able to destroy that. Not yet, anyway. Give them another century or two. The river was folding gently. Excuse me. I use a Blue Yeti microphone. C&K. Also, welcome to the stream. I need to make a specs panel. Glad to hear you're warm now, Lunar. Okay. The river was folding gently before her, like a silver snake, hissing as the water tumbled across a stony bed. Mr. B, please. The oak tree crackled overhead, its branches rasping together in the bracing breeze. Now, to work. She could do the tourist thing all night once her business was complete. A seed. She needed a seed. Holly bent to the ground, brushing the dried leaves and twigs from the clay's surface. Her fingers closed around a smooth acorn. That wasn't hard now, was it? She thought. All that remained for her was to plant it somewhere else, and her powers would come rushing back. Butler checked the portal radar, muting the volume in case the equipment betrayed their position. The red arms swept the screen with agonizing lethargy, and then... Flash! An upright figure by the tree. Too small for an adult, the wrong proportions for a child. He gave Artemis the thumbs up. Possible match. Artemis nodded, strapping the mirrored sunglasses across his brow. Butler followed his lead, popping the cap on his weapon's starlight scope. This was no ordinary dart rifle. It had been specially tooled for a Kenyan ivory hunter, and had the range and rapid-fire capacity of a Kalashnikov. Butler had picked it up for a song from a government official after the ivory poacher's execution. They crept into the night with practiced silence. The diminutive figure before them unhooked a contraption from above its shoulders and lifted a full face helmet from a definitely non-human head. Butler wrapped the rifle strap twice around his wrist, pulling the stock onto his shoulder. He activated the scope, and a red dot appeared in the center of the figure's back. Artemis nodded, and the manservant squeezed the trigger. In spite of a million to one odds, it was at that precise moment that the figure bent low to the earth. Something whizzed over Holly's head, something that glinted in the starlight. Holly had enough on-the-job experience to realize that she was under fire, and immediately curled her elfin frame into a ball, minimizing the target. She drew her pistol, rolling toward the shelter of the tree trunk. Her brain scrambled for possibilities. Who could be shooting at her? And why? Something was waiting beside the tree. Something roughly the size of a mountain, but considerably more mobile.
Nice pea shooter,
grinned the figure, smothering Holly's gun hand in a turnip-sized fist.
Holly managed to extricate her fingers in a nanosecond before they snapped like brittle spaghetti.
I don't suppose you would consider a peaceful surrender, said a cold voice behind her.
Holly turned, elbows raised for combat.
No, sighed the boy melodramatically. I suppose not.
Holly put on her best brave face.
Stay back, human. You don't know what you're dealing with.
The boy laughed.
I believe, fairy, that you're the one unfamiliar with the facts.
Fairy? He knew she was a fairy.
I have magic, mudworm, enough to turn you and your gorilla into pig droppings.
The boy took a step closer.
Brave words, miss. But lies nonetheless. If, as you say, you had magic, you would have no doubt used it by now. No, I suspect that you have gone too long without the ritual, and you're here to replenish your powers.
Holly was dumbfounded. There was a human before her, casually spouting sacred secrets. This was disastrous. Catastrophic. It could mean the end of generations of peace. If the humans were aware of a fairy subculture, it was only a matter of time before the two species went to war. She must do something, and there was only one weapon left in her arsenal. The mesmer is the lowest form of magic and requires only a trickle of power. There are even certain humans with a bent for the talent. It is within the ability of even the most drained fairy to put a complete mind kibosh on any human alive. Holly summoned the final dribble of magic from the base of her skull.
Human,
she intoned, her voice suddenly resonating with bass tones.
Your will is mine.
Artemis smiled, safe behind his mirrored lenses.
I doubt it,
he said, and nodded curtly.
Sleep soon, as she has been sleeping since 11 and told her once.
get some sleep, Lunar. Go get some sleep.
Finally caught someone with the pronouns. Oh, sorry. Never mind.
Artemis Fowl is Irish. It actually says it in the first chapter. Page. Where is it? Page 10. The fairy that he gets the book from calls him English. He says Irish, actually. And then again he says something about being in Dublin. So, my accent might be more Scottish than Irish. I tend to kind of mix the two. But they are, it is my attempt at Irish. It's probably a very poor attempt. It's probably more Scottish, but...
Excuse me.
But yes, Artemis Fowl is Irish. Oh, I know he is Irish. Well, okay. Fair enough. Accent. Yes, it, my accent does veer more towards Scott. I'm not very good at the Irish part. But I was thinking he was more lowland, which is a deeper Irish. I cannot do a deeper Irish brogue. My dad is very good at doing a very deep Irish brogue. I'm just haven't been able to imitate that. I think if I knew someone and talked to someone on a regular basis that has that strong, deep Irish brogue, I could eventually adapt it. But the way that I learn accents, I've always tried for an Irish brogue and it's always sounded more Scottish. So... Good night, Lunar. Sleep well. learning an Irish accent so I can teach you sometime. Awesome. I've tried taking, like, going on YouTube. But for some reason, it always ends up veering more towards Scott. Maybe I'm part Scott. I'm German, Irish, Scotch, Dutch. The rest don't amount to much. So I have Irish in my blood. I have Scot in my blood. I have Dutch in my blood, and German. And that's just one side of my family. My dad also that's my mom's side. My dad's side has Irish, English. Or maybe it was English instead of German. Maybe it was English, Irish, Scotch, Dutch. Something like that. Yeah. It would be English because I'm a distant relative of Sir Francis Drake, who was an English privateer. So I have too many. Yeah, that's the way I say it. I'm just a mutt. I'm a European mutt. Because it's primarily European ancestry. Big part Welsh, nice. Good night, Lunar. Sleep well. Have a fantastic evening. See you next time. Part black, part Puerto Rican, and part Spaniard. Nice! Explains my complexion. Makes sense. But yeah, I would like to work on my Irish brogue, but it always ends up, like, I can make my voice, if I listen to enough Irish brogue, I can make it very Irish for about 3 sentences, and then it starts veering back towards Scottish. I think it might just be because I use that accent a lot, and so my voice is just conditioned towards those particular pronunciations. The Scottish pronunciations, and inflections. Close your throat a little. Okay.
Brave words, miss, but lies nonetheless. If, as you say, you had magic, you would have no doubt used it by now. No, I suspect you have gone too long without the ritual, and you're here to replenish your powers. I don't know if that's better or not, and now I can't get out of it.
I don't know if that was different at all. It felt different, but I don't know if it sounded different. A wee bit. A wee bit's better than none. And another part of my problem is I'm flopping back and forth between English, or like almost a British accent for Holly, and I've noticed that the Scottish is almost Irish with English thrown into the mix. It's weird. Okay. Okay. Holly felt the dart puncture the suit's toughened material, depositing its load of curray and succinyl choline, chloride-based tranquilizer, into her shoulder. Sciencey words.
for my English, I use a London accent. I use this accent. I'm not sure exactly what region it is. But it's to the point where people that actually live in England have thought that I'm legitimately British. Because of the accent. Ray Animated! Thank you for the host. I appreciate that support and you sharing me with your followers and viewers. How are you doing tonight, Rainy? How are you, my friend? Queens. Okay, it's moderately... That sounds Queens Isle. Queens Isle. I was gonna say, Queens is Brooklyn. It's a bit I think a lot of it has been influenced by a lot of my British accent has been influenced by things like Sherlock and Doctor Who, and recently Downton Abbey. So it's kind of weird. I thought my cold medicine was non-drowsy, but it's not, and I'm sleepy. Oh, Rainy! I'm doing pretty well. We're reading Artemis Fowl. It's like an upper part of English. Yeah. Yeah. I've always been told it definitely sounds more proper. I love Artemis Fowl. Yep, I just started reading the first book. I may end up doing like the entire series if people enjoyed enough. I'm trying to do Irish accents for Artemis, but it sounds more Scottish because I'm bad. Okay. The world instantly dissolved into a series of technicolored bubbles, and try as she might, Holly couldn't seem to hang on to more than one thought, and that thought was, how did they know? It spiraled around her head as she sank into unconsciousness. How did they know? How did they know? How did they? Artemis saw the pain in the creature's eyes as the hollow hypodermic needle plunged into her body, and for a moment he experienced misgivings. A female. He hadn't expected that. A female, like Juliet, or Mother. Then the moment passed, and he was himself again. Good shooting, he said, bending to study their prisoner. Definitely a girl. Pretty, too, in a pointy sort of way.
Sir?
Hmm? Butler was pointing to the creature's helmet. It was half buried in a drift of leaves where the fairy had dropped it. A buzzing noise was coming from the crown. Artemis picked up the contraption by the straps, searching for the source.
Ah, here we are.
He plucked the view cam from its slot, careful to point the lens away from Butler.
Very technology. Most impressive.
He muttered, popping the battery from its groove. The camera whined and died.
Nuclear power source, if I'm not mistaken. We must be careful not to underestimate our opponent.
Butler nodded, sliding the captive into an oversized duffel bag. Something else to be lugged across two fields, a bog, and a stile.
Oh. Let me see how long chapter 5 is. Oh god. Oh, nope, I missed it. Oh, that's a lot of pages. I think I might save chapter 5 for next week.
Rainy is awesome. It's so true. Rainy is awesome and wonderful. And if anyone in my stream is not following the lovely Ray Animated, you should absolutely give her a follow. Because she is super awesome and wonderful. There we go. But yes, you should absolutely give her a follow. In fact, you should give everyone on the odd team a follow. Storms, Rainy, Todd, Boo, and Connor. That is the unofficial team. Rainy's pronouns are she. I'm fairly certain. I have not been told otherwise. Rainy uses she pronouns. So, ha! I'm not getting fed to dragons. But you are awesome, so long as I never get casted. Oh look, I'm not awesome no more. Follow Shadow! He's awesome! But yeah, I think that's actually... I know Rainy just hosted and just showed up, but I'm tired now. And... So that might actually... I think that might actually be it for tonight. I'm gonna go change my... I'm gonna change my Twitch name. No Shadow. Not okay. I will cast through your other Twitch name too. But yeah. Got the odd. If you would like to follow me on social media to know, when I stream, other things that are going on, Instagram, I regularly update, well, regularly update with things that I make, and YouTube. I actually upload these Comfy Corner streams onto YouTube. So if you missed this first four chapters of the Artemis Fowl book, if you missed any of that, you can always watch it on YouTube, as well as the other books I've read, such as Tale of Despero, or Dragon Spell, I believe, are the two books that are on there currently. But yeah, that my YouTube is open for that. If you want to hang out outside of streams, we do have a Discord channel where viewers can talk and hang out. It's pretty awesome. I check it semi-regularly. I'm kind of bad sometimes at checking it. I'm not following you. Rainy! Rainy, why? Rainy, please. But yeah, I think that, yeah, okay. I don't generally do raids on Comfy Corner streams because they're meant to be relaxing streams, and, I never know, I never really particularly, I meant that to be like a, Now say it in an Irish accent. That wasn't very Irish. A wee bit. Clench my throat a bit. There we go. How's this? I'm trying a little bit. I don't think it's doing very well. Just talking in a little bit of an accent. I'm not even sure what accent I'm using right now. Playing BNS Blade and Soul. Nice. Huge anime freak. Nice. My page just refreshed itself for some weird reason. That is odd, Mr. B. So yeah, I don't generally do raids on Comfy Corner Night. I will be streaming again tomorrow night, Thursday night. and we will be playing probably more Mass Effect 3. So that should be fun. Look forward to that. And more people dying, because everyone's dying. Good night, Mr. Bolo. Sleep well. I'm actually going to pop up the closing screen. So yes, I will be streaming again tomorrow night. Hope to see you all there. Hope you all have a fantastic evening. And I will see you next time. I got that song stuck in my head. that happens. That happened, Shadow. Good night, Yaki. Sleep well. Just gonna play a little bit of music. I'll miss you too, Rainy. Thank you for coming in. I love you. If you guys are interested in the music that you hear on Comfy Corners, it can be found there on the SoundCloud and is done by Mr. Avanto Music, who sometimes streams himself, oh, Dorkybot can't. I typed it in the wrong thing. There we go. But yes, definitely follow Avanto Music, especially if you enjoy orchestral music. Sometimes he even streams himself working on it. It's pretty cool. Good night, guys. See you on Thursday. Love you all. Could have chosen to be anywhere tonight. You chose to hang with me, and I absolutely appreciate that. See you next time.